October 24th, 2016 school committee meeting to order. We will start tonight by announcing that tonight's school committee meeting is being recorded for RCTV live. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Alan Sander. It's on Comcast Channel 99, Verizon Channel 32. My understanding is that they might be having some technical difficulties back there, so hopefully it's being recorded live. If not, it'll come on quickly. I'm going to start by asking if there's any public comment this evening for an item not on the agenda.
Thank you. Eric Goldstein, President, Reading Teachers Association. Speaking tonight because I've asked a couple of times for the school committee to take up the issue on ballot question number two. And unfortunately, that has not happened. So I wanted to take this opportunity in public comment tonight to express some of our feelings about it and to ask for some action. The Reading Teachers Association opposes question number two. It's a ballot question which, if it was passed, it would allow the state to approve 12 new Commonwealth charter schools every year forever, eventually draining billions of dollars from our public schools and destabilizing our public education system. We are particularly concerned that this law encourages charter schools to expand into areas where they don't exist right now, taking away critical resources from successful public schools, such as us in Reading. This community would make an excellent location to open or expand a charter school. Our district is currently classified as a level 3 district. And with the recent failure of the override, we're going to be facing significant budget cuts and cuts in services next year. Coupled with Reading's excellent commuter location and availability of commercial property by Walker's Brook Drive, I would not be surprised if a charter school targeted the Reading area immediately. Commonwealth charter schools are publicly funded schools, but they're privately operated and they have no local oversight. So that means this committee here would have no say in what happens there. Charter schools also hurt students who attend public schools by siphoning hundreds of millions of dollars from Massachusetts school districts. They also create separate and unequal conditions for success by failing to serve the many high-need students as the host district, such as Reading. Right now, currently over 190 Massachusetts school committees have taken a position against lifting the cap on charter schools, and that list was delivered to the governor's office today. Unfortunately, Reading is not on that list. But Andover, Burlington, Melrose, North Reading, Stoneham, Wilmington, Winchester, Wakefield, and this coming week, Woburn, will all be part of that. And it is on behalf of the Reading Teachers Association that tonight I respectfully ask the Reading School Committee to join us in publicly opposing question number two before it's too late. Thank you. I have materials if anybody needs materials about question two, including a sample resolution, if I can leave those with you for you to look at.
That would be great, Mr. Goldstein. Thank you for coming out and for the other folks that came out tonight. Thank you for that. If you could leave those up there, it's fine. We can all grab them on the way out. Mr. Goldstein has reached out several times over the last few weeks, and given some of the challenges we're facing as a community and looking at our agenda, I wasn't sure that we had the bandwidth to get into this particular discussion. However, over the weekend, I heard from two committee members who would like to engage in this discussion. So that puts us in a challenging place. By open meeting law, this isn't on the agenda, so we can't engage in the discussion now because the public hasn't been adequately notified. What we can engage in is a discussion about whether or not the committee would like to at our next meeting, which is November 7th. So I will open that up for discussion. My thought process continues to be that looking at what's on the agenda for next week, and I can certainly share that, we would need to have a discussion about how much time we would want to devote to this if we want to go down this road, and what perhaps we cut or move off if we want to go down this road. So we need to have that discussion without delving into the merits one way or the other of the ballot question. Do you sort of see the parameters of the discussion? Got that? Okay. Mrs. Webb.
I definitely think that we should discuss it. I understand fully that we had the override in front of us. We really wanted to stay keenly and laser-like focused on that. But I think it's really important that we take this question up and that we discuss it as a committee.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Dunks.
I also feel that. And I feel remiss that we were unable to take it up earlier. I think that our Reading Teacher Association has been really diligent, starting from when I heard the speech at the first day of school. And I think that it's really important for us to discuss it, and so I would like to.
Is it a discussion or a vote or both? Or I guess from the first of all, we're going to have a discussion. I appreciate Mr. Goldstein's perspective and the math teacher. I'd like to hear from the other side of the ballot question as well. And I don't know whether is that possible to get somebody.
I can certainly look into it. It's a good point.
Well, I'm from New York, so it'll be hard to get them.
Well, I mean, I'm not asking for an editorial response. I think that's, if we're going to make an informed decision, we should be listening to both sides of the ballot question, right?
Yeah. If we go down this road, I can certainly look into that.
There's a considerable amount of information on the NISC website about this, as well as, I mean, other websites. There's both websites on the vote no and the vote yes, but considerable information on MASC.
That's true.
Like some of that available, but that would be for our discussion, which I would hope we would take to a vote.
Okay. I'd like to just chime in with everyone. I'd like to have a discussion and a vote next week.
Okay.
I think it's important enough, and it's great that everybody came out to support it, so we're happy to listen.
So, given what's on the agenda for November 7th.
I think it's probably.
Oh, sorry.
Wait. Goes without being said that
I thought we had a majority.
Just want to make public comment that I do, in fact, want to see it discussed and voted on as well, and feel very similar to Dr. Doxa that it hasn't been done previous to this.
So, on our agenda for next week, we are supposed to be getting an update on literacy curriculum, so, an update on the whole district's literacy curriculum. We're also looking at the school calendar and some thinking about that. And also, Dr. Doherty would be presenting on his district goals. So, my question to the committee is, how much time would you want to dedicate to this discussion?
Not next week.
November 7th, the next meeting.
November 7th.
Not on Halloween. So, given that there is appetite for a robust discussion and debate, how much time would you like on the agenda for it? How much time is appropriate?
How much time is allocated for the calendar?
We haven't done the agenda. And the reason I'm asking the question is we can certainly bump something if you would like to.
I would recommend bumping the calendar.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So, we definitely cannot, I didn't realize that would put us the day before the election, which is a shame.
Agreed.
And are we saying that we definitely cannot discuss this tonight, we can't vote on it tonight?
It's not on the agenda. I think it's a violation of open meeting law.
Okay.
We have, and the public wasn't informed, and there are people in the public who very well might want to come to our meeting and engage in this.
Yeah. I'm wondering, because it came to us in writing, we had adequate notice. I know the public hasn't. I'm wondering if we could start a discussion tonight, not do a vote till November 7th. And that way, those of us that have done the reading and have opinions will be able to respond, but it won't be finished. So there'll be able to be the posting so that we could continue that and vote on it November 7th. So anybody that's not here that feels that they should have known, then they aren't cut out of this discussion. They could still come.
We're getting into a legal area I'm not entirely familiar with, Dr. Doherty. Just because of your experience, do you have any insight into if that's permissible?
Well, your policy does talk about, I mean, you're already having a discussion from public input, which
right.
normally you don't do.
Right.
Where it isn't on the agenda, it probably isn't something you can have a full-fledged discussion on tonight.
Okay. That meshes up with my understanding of open meeting law as well. So we'll put it on the agenda for November 7th, and see curriculum update, district goals. Give me some guideline. 30 minutes?
I would think so.
I can do more if
yeah,
there's
I
more.
Think that you'll let the dis- sorry.
Yeah.
You let the discussion just play itself out. I
okay.
wouldn't put a time limit.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, why don't we put it at the top of the agenda, though? Yeah, Dr.
I have just a couple of thoughts. Since it, you have consensus that you want to put on the agenda, I think having it before the election is the piece I think that's important, so that people can hear the discussion, and also that's that the RTA, which came to you, knows that you're having that discussion. So I think, to your comment, I think if, having it before the election, I think it's fine, even though it's the day before. My second question slash comment, is there materials that you would like me to get to put into your packet? I mean, I can start with the League of Women Voters information that was sent to every home
That's
in the Commonwealth that has both the pro and the con.
That's a very thoughtful suggestion. Thank you.
And if there is any other information out there that...
Can I ask a couple of the more veteran members, is there precedent, because I'm in uncharted territory here, is there precedent for the school committee weighing in on state matters? To Dr. Dory's question, is there a protocol that's worked in the past? With how to gather information? Do you hear both sides?
I think it's usually, sorry, been up to the committee members to sort of gather the data on their own. I think for... It could be for those of us who have gathered data, we could give it to Dr. Daugherty so that it could go to all the committee members. I mean, that is done at times, so we could do that if we, you know, wanted to save Dr. Daugherty the time of digging it up. And
I don't recall any recent, in recent memory, where we've taken a position on a ballot question.
Oh, other than a local ballot question.
I mean, I'm talking about a state ballot question.
Well, I was thinking of other boards do, like the RACASA board takes a position on question four.
I didn't even think of that. Is that something we should be discussing as well?
Question four? I think so, but...
Well, I mean, we're in these waters, so
I think that it would be good to have Dr. Daugherty get information out so that we all have at least some of the same information, and maybe one way to handle that is if we've collected information, we could get that to Dr. Daugherty and he could include that in the packages or send it out electronically or something. On this question too.
I rather liked the League of Women Voters suggestion because that seems very even-handed and it's probably a manageable amount of information.
Well, certainly the MASC also has it. I mean, that's our association.
And also, I think for the public, wanting to use the packet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I like that suggestion. But Mrs. Webb, was that a suggestion that we look at question four as well?
I was really just drawing the parallel that other boards in town do look at and sort of weigh in on ballot questions and you know, put a press release out at times. So
I think we have a plan. Thank you, Mr. Goldstein, and for everyone else for being here tonight. Oh, I'm sorry, Dr. Toxic.
No, I did, but it went right out of my brain.
Well, we'll be discussing it again on the 7th. Any other public comment this evening? Yes, please.
Good evening. I'm John Lippert. I'm a resident here in Reading. No longer have kids in the school system. They're beyond that. But I just wanted to add a couple of things to the excellent comments that Mr. Goldstein made. First of all, I would like to comment, though, that in terms of a school committee endorsing a state ballot question, 190 school committees in Massachusetts have done it. So clearly there's plenty of precedent out there. I don't think there's anything you need to worry about in terms of doing that.
That wasn't what we were discussing. We were discussing what this board has done in the past.
Yeah. Just to quantify a couple of things, currently $450 million a year in this statewide, is leaving local public school systems and going to charter schools. If this question passes, that could increase by $100 million each and every year. So $550 million, $650 million, up to significant amounts. I guess, given that the override didn't pass, I had a yes and a no lawn sign on my lawn. I think it's even more important that we take a clear stand because this is another thing that would take away money from our schools. And obviously, we're saying that we need the money in our schools. And I guess the last comment I'd make is, if I were you, what I'd be worried about, or the school system here in Reading, is I guess there are 100 and some odd kids who go to private school and parents are paying tuition. If a charter school came in anywhere near here that they thought was comparable, they could send those kids to that charter school for free. And it would cost the Reading school system instead of the parents the money. And I'm sure you can do the math as quickly as I can, but if it's 100 kids and we're losing about $12,000 per kid, that's $1.2 million. Melrose is losing $2.5 million to the charter school down in Malvern. So there's nothing to say that that couldn't impact Reading. Currently, 231 school districts in the state are losing money to charter schools, as Reading is for, I guess, it's one kid. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Sullivan, for being here tonight. Yes.
I did remember what I was going to say. And it was to reiterate that I think the calendar could wait. We have some time.
Oh, I've already moved it.
Oh, all right.
Can I interrupt you for just 1 second on that? Dr. Doherty, do you have any time frame on needing the calendar approved by our committee? So I just moved it to the...
We've traditionally had it done by early December.
So I'm going to move that to November 22nd, mm-hmm. which pushes us close to that. That's along with high school initiatives, the guidance report, and the late start committee update. I think we can do that all in one night.
Yep.
Don't you agree?
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
The other piece that I was going to say was that I want to emphasize that the superintendent's goals cannot wait, because that's on the agenda for the November 7th,
yes.
right? I don't think those can wait. I think that this third year, we need to get it right and do that in time to have his evaluation done by June when it's mm-hmm. supposed to be done. And so we need to keep that solid. I was going to make a sort of jokey comment that we all need to get a good night's sleep the night before, because if our meeting ends up going a little longer, so be it. Because I think that the teachers will be counting on doing their literacy presentation and the administration, and it's really important to give them the time, and we've been waiting and eager to hear about that. So I think it will be a full docket. But I think it's important to do it
okay.
and to keep the superintendent's goals
okay.
in that meeting.
Okay. Thank you. We do have a protocol that we don't like our meetings to go beyond 2.5 hours, and out of respect to the staff who's here and some of us who have early mornings, I'm not willing to go to midnight. And if it means we push something off to the next week, I think we push it off to the next week. I agree with you. I'd rather have a robust discussion around everything we want to have a robust discussion around. And a little bit later is okay. Not too far outside our protocols. Okay. Oh, yes. Hi.
Yes, I know.
Oh, thank you. That's a new protocol, too.
Oh, is it?
We're
okay,
getting used
sorry.
To that.
Just to be brief, because I realize we're going to discuss this next time we meet. My name is Jim Roscoe. I've lived in Reading all my life, as my parents and grandparents. I've started teaching here back in the 80s, and I now teach in Somerville. I wanted to give you a perspective of a town or a district that's charter schools have really impacted. And it demographically, it's different, but it doesn't have to be different in the fact that a charter school all of a sudden presents itself. And we have, it's cost us $7 million. But I'm going to talk about the trenches, because I'm in the trenches. It's not theory. I'm in the classroom where I see children leave and go to the charter school, maybe one from one of my classes and maybe one from another class. It doesn't affect my lesson plans, or it's one less paper to crack, but the money's gone. I also want to speak about the fact that there are kids entering my classroom throughout the year. And these are the children that went to a charter school and weren't the right fit. Some voluntarily came back, some didn't voluntarily come back. But the dynamic here is that the children that I did lose, you know, you hear the cliches of the cream of the crop or something. You have really proactive parents that want to do something in that situation, and so it's emotional, because I'm not against charter schools. On the other hand, It's not a level playing field. It really isn't. The children I'm getting back from the charter schools, in most cases, are difficult children. And I'm in a public school. I have to teach everybody, you know, and I diversify my, you know, way of teaching. I try to work with that child. And that's something that I'm sure everybody in this room became a teacher on the school committee because they care for children. And truly, no one, too, is caring about children. I teach my kids DBQs. And ironically, I have a sophomore daughter, and I go home and help my daughter with the DBQ document. I had a question about document, primary source. And I always teach the children to, we all have a side, and legit, a pro and a con. But you really need to look at who wrote the document and who's saying this. And I'm stunned at where the money is coming from charter schools. It's scary. And this whole veil of secrecy. Teachers unions are giving millions. Yes. Yep. Right here. And that's because we care about children. And we want every child educated. But to have money coming in from the Waltons, and I don't mean John Boy, is why? What's their motivation? I tell the kids, why did they write this? What is their motivation? What do they really want? And well, ask yourselves that. What do they want? Millions and millions and millions of dollars. The Waltons, $2 million alone, $20 million of money from New York and other places. What? To help children? I don't know. Maybe some. But that's the real issue. I think we have an obligation to say, you know, no. I'm not against charter schools. There's a place for charter schools. Absolutely. But unlimited, unwarranted charter schools, privately run, supported by dark money going through multiple hands. These commercials, oh my God. I keep saying, no, you can't vote. You can't vote yes. These commercials, they suck you right in. It's just, it's everyone's being hoodwinked. It's not true. And I just want to put a face on somebody who's been impacted by charter schools. And you know, I love the kids that leave. And I miss them. And I love the kids that come back. And I teach them. But it's a dynamic that, it's a lot of times it's socioeconomics. These poor parents want the best for their children as I would. I'm fortunate to be living in Reading, and my children have gone through and are going through the Reading public school system. You all should be very proud of yourselves, except for the DBQs that I have to do with my daughter every now. But I guess what I'm saying is that if it happens to you, it really impacts the teacher in the trenches. You know, and it's not something that's abstract, and it affects you. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Roscoe.
Yes,
Ms. Calafaggi.
Discussion.
Yeah. Well, we're not discussing. It's public comment, so it's okay. The public. I just want to clarify because Mr. Robinson said something interesting. The public can comment all night long, and we just listen. That's allowed. It's when we start debating and discussing that the public needs notice. So that's why we're continuing to listen.
Hi, I'm Erin Calvo-Bacci, and I just have a question in regards to the money that would leave because of the charter schools. How does that differ, if you can explain to me, with the students that go to the tech schools? How does that differ?
So you just took us into next week.
Okay.
Because to answer that question, we will now have to engage.
Oh,
or
okay.
I'd have to point you to people in the audience, and then
okay.
then the whole meeting stops becoming a school committee meeting and another kind of meeting. So if you could bring that to next week's, or send an email.
To
if you can't be here in person, send an email perfect. For clarification.
Okay, thank
I'm
you.
Sorry that I can't
no,
answer that.
No, that's fine. Thank you.
Thanks. Any other public comment on this or anything else not on the agenda? Well, thank you so much for being here tonight, and that's it for public comment. You don't want to stay for consent agenda? All right, I'm going to take a 2-minute recess so we can clear the room. October 24, 2016 school committee meeting back to session. public comment is over. We're on to the consent agenda.
Is there anything anybody would like to remove from the consent agenda?
Yeah, I'm supposed to say it. I always forget.
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
I'll second that. All those in favor? 6-0.
You should leave that door open.
Yeah, do leave it open.
Even though the other one's open?
Doesn't matter.
And we are on to reports. Mario, do you have a report to make?
Not much, really. The varsity girls field hockey team, I know right now, is having their senior night, so they're playing Woburn, I think.
But things are going good?
Yeah.
How about from the committee, any liaison or subcommittee reports?
The wedding singer is coming up.
Oh.
Just wanted to mention that.
Mm-hmm.
With the high school drama club.
Yep, looks very funny.
Jean.
Oh, yes, Mrs.
You're supposed to say the CPAC.
Thank you.
There was another item. The Brandon Coalition of Substance Abuse meets again this week on Thursday, and actually last week there was the Hidden in Plain Sight, which I think actually several school committee members were able to go to, and I think it was great that we could bring it to the community. And I think it generated some good dialogue. I don't know what we'll get a report from Erica on Thursday, you know, how many people sort of came through and saw it. I know personally I was really pleased my 22-year-old son came out of Boston and his girlfriend went through it with us with perhaps a different perspective than I have. And it was, you know, really made it even more informative for me. But I'm really appreciative that we could bring that to Reading. And I think it was something that for parents of especially younger kids, maybe middle school or elementary school, it's I think really eye-opening. So I appreciate that.
On a related note, on November 30th, I believe, the RCASA is having a presentation and a filming of Breaking Points. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Doherty is going to, and Linda will make sure the school committee is posted. So if we have a quorum at that, that will be fine. Any other committee reports? Quiet night. Dr. Doherty and
I think Mrs. Wilson has a report.
Just a quick report today. I attended a meeting at the SEAM Collaborative with North Reading Transportation. They're the vendor that does our special education transportation. At least annually, we have a meeting at the SEAM Collaborative with representatives from North Reading Transportation and the members of SEAM, because SEAM manages the contract. We review the safety protocols they have in place for the vans and buses that we utilize for transportation. We went over the training that they do for their bus drivers and the monitors on the bus. We talked about the routes, how routes are designed, and we also went through communication and how to improve some of the communication. So that was today, and then as was mentioned, tomorrow night is the CPAC presentation on anxiety and school performance. It will be at 7:00 in the library here at the high school, and the presenter is from the Middlesex Youth Partnership. So
my understanding is there's a lot of interest in that presentation.
Yes.
And I think that's great. It's an important topic. We'll hear from you in
a
little
report.
Bit.
Yeah.
That's good. Dr. Doherty,
you know.
No,
okay.
I'm under old business.
Old business.
I'm going to pass out to you a memo that the town manager is going to give to the selectmen tomorrow night. That the school committee, I know, would be interested in, so I wanted to share it with you. And I did get permission from the town manager to share this prior to the selectmen's meeting. And it deals with the Killam Field project, which was scheduled to happen this summer, the summer of 2017. That project has now been, and the work was going to begin, the engineering work, and those pieces were going to begin actually in the next month or so. That project has now been put on hold and will no longer be funded, and the funding that was appropriated in the capital project for that is now going to be used for something else or returned back to free cash. And the town manager put several reasons for this. One is, as I mentioned to you at the last meeting, MSBA is coming in this week and next week to all of our schools to evaluate all the buildings to see, to give it a rating. And certainly Killam is a school that does need some work, and we're not sure what the MSBA is going to come back for as a rating. So there may be some work done in Killam in the future, and to put in a brand new field and irrigation system and do a completely new parking lot pavement in the back where potentially there could be some work done in the future there is probably not a good idea. So that's one of the reasons why it's put on hold. Obviously, another reason is that the override did not pass last week, and so they're looking at all possible expenses. And then another reason is that two of the four key town staff positions that would oversee this project are currently vacant. So for those reasons and other reasons that are listed here in the memo, this project's been put on hold. So I wanted to make sure that the committee was aware of that. Moving forward. The other thing I wanted to mention is I had the opportunity to go to the Northeast School Band Association marching band competition here on Saturday night. I believe this is like the fifth or sixth year in a row that Reading has hosted it from bands from all over the region. And it was a little bit challenging because of the weather on Saturday, but they did find an amount of time where it wasn't raining, and so they were able to get it all in and done by about 9:30 Saturday night. Reading did quite well. The color guard and the band did very well. They received a gold and did come in second in their division, and the color guard was honored as well with some additional awards for the quality of their performance. So I just wanted to make sure that the band was recognized, and I appreciate all the work that our band and color guard do. They are out here every Wednesday night working hard in all types of weather, so they do a great job. That's all my report.
There's nothing else, then I think we're gonna dive into state assessment data.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So as we do every year, this is an opportunity for us to take a look at the state assessment data from a district lens. So I had several things in addition to the slides here. I also have asked that the color copies of the community update that we sent out several weeks ago are available too, because there's sort of different levels to this data. So the slides tonight, we're going to sort of focus on the district aggregate at that level. On these tables, though, that I put together a few weeks ago, this also includes the school by and grade levels, which allows us to sort of see if there's any differences or inconsistencies among schools and different grades, which is another lens that we can talk a little bit about. I thought, too, and speaking of this, I wanted to clarify, because I know there are some questions, and several parents asked me, and I think even on social media there are some questions and things I was told about when we get this data and so forth from this. So I wanted to clarify, because one little thing happened a little bit differently this year, but not much. So what happens is usually, and the state has been doing this for years, with a little bit of variability in the timing, but usually by about the end of the summer, certainly right before school starts, we get what's called, there's two things. There's the accountability data, which is essentially what levels and so forth the overall school and district is falling into, but without any of the data as to why. So we get sort of that overview. In terms of the assessment data itself, they release to us what's called preliminary data for us to really just to look at to see if there's any errors, things that don't look right, and so forth. And literally that comes in just pages and pages of columns. Nothing has been aggregated. We're looking to let them know if, first of all, is it our data? Are there any blanks? Are there things that's looking? I remember one time as principal of Coolidge years ago, I remember seeing a group of students that were blank, and we knew those students all took the test, and we were able to inform the state, and they made the correction. There was just some glitch in that. So we're not able to get sort of the aggregate totals at that time. I mean, to be honest, I guess
technically it would be possible for us to convert into Excel and start doing a lot of work to aggregate that. We just have never done that. We don't quite have the capacity to do that for something that essentially within 2 or 3 weeks the state's going to give us. So we have never tried to do all that ahead of time. So then when we released this update, that was when the state did release all of that in aggregate form to us. What was a little bit different this year is normally they release it to us about a week, sometimes two, before it's released to the public. And this year we really just had a couple days. It was sort of over the weekend. So that was sort of the timing of how things went this year. In the handout, though, before I get to the slides, I mean, clearly, and we can talk a little bit about it as we get through the end, I mean, clearly there are some areas. I mean, the level three with Eaton is, you know, I addressed here and it will address tonight as well. And Principal Sprung is also here at the end that we've asked him to sort of give an update to the committee about where we stand with that. Some of the things that sort of jump out in this, the areas like the grade three at Eaton, which I'm sure Mr. Sprung will talk about. Grade five at Barrows looks a little bit different than some of the others. Some differences in the science at the middle level, which we talked a little bit about last year also. Even the math in eighth grade. And I'm saying all these things because all of the schools, by the way, have already given their own presentations to their communities. And as I've talked with the principals, I know that they've talked very transparently, not only with the community, but their own staff. And I know that, you know, for instance, if there's some differences among a couple of schools or across the district, staff are also collaborating to take a look at some of those reasons. So we can go through a little bit about that tonight. So from the district perspective, though, which was interesting to sort of, as I was putting these slides together, I mean, we sort of see some positive trends. I mean, as you know, there are still two assessments being given by the state. One is still the MCAS, or MCAS 1.0, I guess, as we're getting ready to go to 2.0. And that was given this last spring in, at all three levels, grades 5, 8, and 9 of science, and it's also still the high school test for ELA and math. And then, of course, we had the PARC assessment, which is given for ELA and ELA literacy in grades 3 through 8, same for mathematics. And then with PARC, there is also an Algebra 1 eighth grade option, which all of our students that were enrolled in Algebra 1 took again this year. So I'm gonna do it this sort of in different sections. I thought instead of waiting for questions at the end, I going to kind of go through a brief section of, with the MCAS tests, then moving to PARC, we'll kind of take a look at ELA, and maybe I'll kind of take a break or welcome questions in between these sections. Then the PARC math, and then go into sort of the high needs versus the aggregate and sort of a, that view as well. So we'll try to pause between each section to see if there are specific questions. So, I mean, I sort of give this information every year. I mean, obviously, we use the results for several ways. We want to look at how we are doing, and that means not only as a school or as a district, but also the subgroups, especially our high needs group or students with disabilities, even a subgroup within that group, and even individual students. And so that begins as soon as we get all of this data, because we want to see if there are kids who kids or groups who need special attention or interventions. It informs our practices. How is our curriculum aligned, instructional practices, and so forth. So let's start with the MCAS. So the MCAS really hasn't changed. Their performance levels fall into those categories: advanced, proficient, needs improvement, and warning. I believe I'm starting here with science. And so what I've done here on the slides is not only show this year's levels, but I always like to look at this from a district perspective by comparing it to past years. So on this slide, I love this new screen, by the way, because the bars are actually the color that they were when I, before sometimes it would be hard. So it's nice that the color is looking true there. So 2016, this last spring, is in sort of the orange color to the farthest right. And along the bottom there on that axis, you see the different levels: warning, needs improvement, proficient, advanced. And then the farthest right is a combination of proficient and advanced, because we always look at that, those two categories combined, because that tells us what percentage of our students are meeting or exceeding the standards. And the state also provides that information in that way. So a couple things about this, and I will say it again when I sort of wrap things up and look at how the state is transitioning. I mean, as you know, we started last year piloting or addressing, first of all, our science curriculum, because it hasn't been updated in many years. And last year in fifth grade, it's the first year we were piloting the No Atom program. The state's going to be transitioning to these standards and the way that they're being assessed over the course of the next few years. As you can see, I mean, I was a little disappointed. I mean, I didn't know exactly what would happen. You know, we're looking at that. There's lots of different reasons. I mean, it's a different cohort of kids. Overall, though, we still feel very confident that within the next couple years, we're going to see an impact. The state makes clear, and I think I have a slide near the end that talks about their transition, that the grade 5 test and the grade 8 test is a cumulative test. So in other words, the grade 5 assessment is designed to assess grades 3, 4, and 5. Okay, it's not just the fifth grade. The same way for grade 8, it's assessing 6, 7, and 8, everything since 5. So this year, as you know, we just didn't do one grade level. We actually have grades 3, 4, and 5. We're hoping now that over the next couple of years, by the time the state transitions to the new assessment for science, which will be in a couple years, that everything will be aligned and we're getting the results that we want. And that goes for the middle level as well. Things were a little bit higher than last year, but again, as I put in the note there, this is clearly still an area that we're focusing on and that we are addressing, because we're not happy with those results yet. But again, I think it's been overdue for us to address our science curriculum. And so that process began this year, or last year. At the high school level, you can see, though, I mean, they actually had higher results than we've had in the past. 91% of high school students are now scoring in the proficient or advanced range. And you can see how that breaks out with the different categories and compare it to the other years as well. Sticking with the MCAS, as we look at English Language Arts now at the high school, I think this received their highest level in terms of achievement, with 99% of kids now at the high school achieving at the advanced or proficient level. So that 99% actually includes 64% scoring at the advanced level. And then in math, also very high percentile, 93% of the high school students are scoring proficient or higher, which includes 70% scoring at the advanced level. Before I go into Park, any questions or comments just about the MCAS portion?
Yeah. Craig, I did have a question about the science, especially the grade 5 scores. And I know you kind of just explained that, but I just feel like there's a disconnect. We piloted this new program, and yet our scores are lower this year for the fifth grade. And if you, and I know it, when I look at the chart, it seems like there's more of a discrepancy than when I'm looking at the graph. When I'm looking at the numbers here that you've presented, it just, I'm
school
looking.
School by school, you mean?
Yeah, school by school.
Yep.
I mean, you know, the proficient to higher, you know, dramatically dropped at Barrows, dropped slightly at Birch Meadow, dramatically dropped at Eaton, dramatically dropped at Killam. So I'm concerned that we spent all of this time, we identified this new program, and it's not translating. And I kind of get lost in the, it's not, you know, they're changing the standards. I mean, it's still, science is sciences.
So, I mean, a couple things. I mean, first of all, we agree.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So I do think that the fact that it's a test that's assessing several grade levels at once, that would explain why we wouldn't get an immediate. Also, I don't think it's unusual as we're transitioning to a new program, especially in a pilot year. Like, to me, the biggest indicator that I'm looking at, which is what you alluded to, isn't necessarily that level, but the variation among the schools.
Mm-hmm.
And in some ways that's a problem, in other ways it provides us an opportunity because the teachers are collaborating now to make sure, you know, what was really working well, what was being addressed well, what wasn't being addressed well. And I also think the more that we have it at multi-grade levels and those students then will have a year or two under their belt before they get to the state assessment will make a big difference. Yeah, I mean, we're still unpacking that and looking. I mean, for the schools that had some lower scores than others, I mean, they start digging into that and actually looking at the specific students to see, you know, what was the cohort that year and, you know, was there reasons that they can identify why certain students didn't do as well as maybe they had thought that they would.
Mrs. Huff?
Yeah, I guess that was my question. In terms of sort of that unpacking and looking at the specific results for the schools to try to understand, you know, in each school, what were the strands or, you know, was it broadly or was it more focused?
Yeah.
In the past, I think it's been difficult. Well, if I go back to when my kids were in elementary, which is now a long time ago, the processes to move the data and have it be informative were really difficult. And I'm sort of wondering, has anything improved about that process for teachers so that they can get their hands on that data more quickly to understand, you know, exactly what strands all kids missed or, you know, a subgroup of kids missed, you know, some particular element.
Mm-hmm.
Are we doing that more efficiently? Is there?
We are, and that's something, and for the science, again, it's interesting. I mean, we're still getting that type of information from the MCAS test, that breakdown by strand. Again, that's still going to be shifting over the next couple of years. I mean, the state assessment is still assessing the old standards, but absolutely we do have that. Again, I think it's sort of a three-year process. We'll see in the other slides, there's some things, even ELA and math, which we're now sort of 3 years into the transition of some new programs, some new instructional approaches, and even now the new assessments, we can kind of see at some point in some of the slides upcoming sort of how even the bar graphs look over the course of 3 or 4 years when these transitions are happening. I don't think that Reading is unique in that way. I do think our scores in science are lower than they should be, even compared to other communities. But that has been happening, that's not new. I think that's something that we just have not had the resources to make that change, and then we started waiting until the standards were going to shift because it wouldn't have been wise to make large investments until we knew what we were shifting to.
Okay. I had actually the same question as excuse me, I'm getting over an infection. The same question as Mrs. Joyce. I expected a bump after a year of a brand new science curriculum with so much more focus on science in the classroom. So my question is, if it's about transition, what should we feel if this happens again next year? You know, is there a time frame where you look and say something isn't, you know, when do you stop saying this is about transition and there's a bigger problem? How do you make that judgment?
Yeah, I mean, I think we need to look at the data each year to overall, I mean, yes, I would love to see the bump. I'm expecting that we'll have one next year, but overall, our whole approach has been sort of a three-year process, knowing that, but we needed to get started because when the state shifts their assessment, we need to have everything running on all cylinders. And so we've planned it so that when that happens, we will at that time have a fifth grade class or an eighth grade class that have completely made it the transition. And by that, I mean that they have the 3 years behind them in that. So that was our planning in terms of why we started transitioning when we did to get ready for that. I mean, yes, I hope we see incremental steps of progress, but I really think that our biggest one would probably be happening when we have that full sort of few years behind. Otherwise, you're backfilling, even in math. I mean, we've been seeing that, for instance. You know, it takes a few years for the students to have the background. Otherwise, your sort of teachers are sort of backfilling years when the curriculum has changed and they haven't had that instruction in previous years.
So it sounds like your answer is 3 years. It's like somewhere around the 3-year mark, if you didn't start seeing improvement, you would have concern.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
do something fundamentally
And even when we looked at other districts, I know I was talking about like North Reading, I think, you know, they implemented in grades 3, 4, and 5, and I believe that's when, you know, they start seeing the difference. And especially because it's an assessment that assesses 3 years.
Thank you for that answer. Mr. Nye?
How often do the elementary students, grade 3, 4, and 5, actually have science per week?
So it is, let me double check. So it's every other day, I believe, is the,
I think so.
Yeah, yep. Which is also in line with the, if you went to the state website, they sort of give suggested minutes per week. So it breaks down a different way. So it's about, I think they say it's like 2.5 to 3 hours for these grade levels suggested per week. So different school systems break it up in different ways. Is that pretty accurate, elementary principals? Did I say that properly?
80 minutes for science and 80 minutes for social studies.
Right.
Mrs. Bell.
So I assume, though, with respect to the new curriculum, there are, I would assume, many other assessments that we're doing or evaluations, markers that we have looking at that program, not just the MCAS, in terms of implementing that program, looking at other assessments that students are taking. So I would assume that, I mean, we're not like waiting to evaluate how well we're doing implementing the curriculum or how students are doing with the curriculum for the MCAS results or the PARC results at the end of the year. Is that a true statement?
Yes, but we're also still developing because the science program is new and the standards have shifted. We're still in the process of, well, as developing sort of our own internal assessments to how to best monitor that progress as kids go along. I mean, I'm hoping, for instance, that even this fifth grade class that's now in sixth grade, and sixth grade is also transitioning, that by the time that they get to the eighth grade mm-hmm. assessment, that we absolutely see a big change. And that's what that would, you know, align with what the fifth grade teachers were telling me, that they felt very confident that while it may have not been assessed or showed in the assessment of the state, that they developed students in fifth grade that had a different understanding of the scientific process mm-hmm. that would prepare them well for middle school. And they felt that the kids would have that understanding better than they had in the past. May not have shown up yet on this particular assessment, but I'm hoping it shows up in their experiences in science in sixth grade. Unfortunately, there's not a state assessment again until eighth grade in science, but our hopes and plans are that it would show up for those students when they get to eighth grade.
Yep, Dr. Doxer.
Did the teachers have a theory why they didn't think it showed up on the tests?
No. I mean, I think it varies. They really have to look at each cohort, you know, and you know, at each school, so which we were in the process of doing.
Are they releasing all of the questions?
No. I don't believe they would get some, but it's not.
Yeah,
all
they don't. They don't release them all.
Yeah, it's always some.
Is that coming with MCAS 2.0? A full
yeah,
release?
Yeah, you know, I was
going to
say, which I'll actually be glad for, even in ELA and math. I mean, the reason that we felt it was very important for us to shift over to PARC was because it was a major shift in the type of questions that kids would have to be, you know, would be facing, and it really has driven our process, driven our instruction, and so forth. So we thought that was very important. If I had to pick, in my mind, the biggest advantage to Massachusetts now deciding to do an assessment that we're anticipating will look very much like PARC, but it will be unique to Massachusetts, is that I'm hoping now that the state will be able to provide the layers of detail that they have in the past, in their own way, on their own timetable. So we'll see, but I think that would be their plan, because I do think that's been an advantage in the past, that we've been able to look at the, you know, as you mentioned, I think it was the strand analysis or the, you know, standard by standard, what types of questions. In many cases, they would even show us, like the high school, for instance, ELA and math, they're able to see released questions and exactly how many students answered that question a particular way. If it wasn't released question, at least they would tell you what the standard was or the strand was, and still tell you how the kids answered, even if it didn't show you the exact question. And that's really helpful as we analyze and we keep preparing and adjusting our curriculum and instruction.
I have a question. If we're done with science, did you have a science question?
I maybe this is for a different part of the discussion, but I just, we're talking about what we expect to see in a couple of years, and I'm just sort of, I think that's a different discussion about what our goals are going to be.
Yep.
Because we're going to have, a much larger speed bump than we would want to have, and I think we just have to be cognizant of that when we're talking about this, and you know, we want to see the improvement, but it's going to be challenging.
Can I ask a question? That's actually a high school question on MCAS. So this is more me bouncing my thinking off of you to see if I'm on the right track. So the RMHS 10th grade data was fantastic. Mm-hmm. And obviously the high school went from a level 2 to a level 1 school. This is great news. Particularly the Mass SGP, the growth in the math was fantastic. So that seemed like pure good news. I did notice, from my perspective, the student growth perspective on 10th grade ELA was a little lower than our kids have at lower grade levels in ELA. So what I wondered is how that reads to me, is we do a really good job of getting everyone up to proficient and a lot of advanced too, a big number of advanced, but kids in that same cohort across the state are growing even more. Do you know what I'm saying? So does it suggest that we maybe need to do a better job focusing on the higher advanced learners and pushing them even further?
Yeah.
Why was that student growth a little bit lower than it is?
I mean, overall, I do have a section coming up that will focus just on the student growth, and we can look at that.
Okay.
I mean, I think my first answer would be that once you get into like the 98th and 99th percentile, it's just the room for growth. Like if you're still in that 40 to 60, which they consider like the expected, if you're, you know, so the 50th percentile would be like, that's where most people are growing. In some cases, you're literally talking about a question or two. And so anything could go either way. So to me, to be at that high of a percentile and still be falling in the moderate growth range is good, because I think there are also schools that are really high, but then their growth is even considered low growth, because they're so high and they've kind of been there for the last couple of years. So there's just not much room to maneuver. I think that's the biggest part of it. But we can look at it a little bit more when we get to the growth section.
Thanks. Anything else on MCAS?
No.
Okay. Thanks, Mr. Webb.
Okay, so moving on to the PARC assessment. And as we explained this year, or last year, the PARC uses some different indicators instead of the advanced and proficient and so forth. They use 5 levels, starting with level 1 and moving up to level 5. Level 4 is in green there, and that's the level that is defined as meeting expectations, and level 5 is exceeding expectations. So similar to the MCAS, where we would like to see our students, as many of our students as possible, meeting or exceeding expectations. So we're looking to move kids into the level 4 and 5 on the PARC. So we can begin with ELA grade 3. So what I've done is we have a series of slides that kind of look at each grade level, comparing this year to last year's PARC. And then I'm going to show a few slides that kind of show a history of sort of 5 years to kind of also look at the transition from MCAS to PARC. So this is grade 3. The purple bar on the right is the percentage of students at each level for this last spring, 2016, and the green bar is last year. Okay, so this year you can see 64% in level 4 and 5, up from 57 from last year. Grade 4. Very similar statistically to last year. Grade 5, the higher of the grade levels in elementary, but still fairly consistent from the previous year. Moving into middle school, grade 6, again higher levels at levels 4 and 5, or higher percentages at levels 4 and 5. Fairly similar to last year. Grade 7. Again, fairly similar, but all of them so far have shown some improvement of a couple percent. To me, once it gets above a couple percent, then it starts to become a little bit more significant. Again, it's a different cohort of kids. And then grade 8. I do think grade 8 is one of the more challenging tests, but again, a fairly good increase in the percentage of level 4 and 5 there. This slide just sort of shows a cumulative overview, and the state presents it this way as well. If we look at our overall, all of the students, grades 3 through 8, before they get to high school, what percentages do we have overall each one of these? And so this year it was 75% overall of those grades were at level 4 or 5, meeting or exceeding expectations. So then I wanted to take a look at it, and I've done this for math too, which is in some ways even more interesting to me, but I started last year looking at sort of the 5-year span, which I think at this particular time is even more interesting because, you know, we've been transitioning. So, you know, I went back to 2012. So 2012, 2013, and 2014 were still the MCAS tests. In ELA, it was 2013 where the state was transitioning to new standards in ELA. So 2014 then was really sort of a full assessment of those standards, but still with the MCAS. PARC 2015 then was not only the new standards, but a new assessment, which the state has described as a more rigorous assessment. Pretty happy though with the increase from last year, even in grade 3, the first time in 2016. And the reason I liked looking at these at all different grade levels is obviously my goal would be that 2016, 2017 bars are looking much like it did in 2012 or 2011 or so forth. That, you know, when are we getting back to the levels of performance or even higher than we were before the transition to new standards and new assessments? So as we look at this, this was grade 3, this is grade 4. Grade 5. Grade 6. Grade 7. Really done this presentation this way. You kind of see the bars move very instantly. And grade 8. So again, a fairly significant improvement from 2015 to 2016, but still I think the 8th grade is one of the most challenging tests, and we're still not there yet, but I think we're making progress and getting back to where we should be. Okay, so anything before I go into some math? Anything on ELA and grades 3 through 8?
Am I right that grade 3 seems to be particularly problematic in terms of percentage of kids scoring proficient and advanced?
Yeah, I mean,
at 64%, that seems low to me
yeah.
at such a young age.
Let's see if I go back there. Yeah, absolutely. As you know, I mean, for a couple of our schools, one in particular, that's been more of a challenge. But even as we look at it historically, I mean, even, you know, the MCAS, again, I think it's been one of the lower levels, but yeah, that's something that we're looking at. And I think that as we address that at a school or two, those numbers should go up. But I also think that we're having an impact on the aggregate overview for the district as well. I mean, it looks like, let's see, where were we, about 73% to 75% before in 2012, 2013.
Yeah, now that I'm actually...
2014, when the standard shifted, it was about 65%, maybe 67%, I'd have to look.
And I'm now looking at the grid, and you're right, it does seem to be somewhat school-specific.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Anything else on ELA?
Oh, sorry, Dr. Dobbs.
I'm just wondering, I have the feeling that once the scores are released, there becomes this frenzy around the scores, and part of what I'm curious about is the differential between the teachers' perceptions of these scores and the other accountability and performance measures that we have mm-hmm. that are in place. I know that all the DDMs aren't aren't all finished yet, but there are other accountability measures that we have in place, and I'm wondering if there's, the teachers are seeing the consistency between those measures and the results that we're getting on these tests, or whether there's a discrepancy that...
Yes and no. I mean, I'll talk about it at the end, some of the things that we're looking at. I mean, one of the things is, yes, as we're looking at our own district's common assessments, what we're realizing is because we've been, it's also happening during a shift of standards and of the assessments, that we need to make sure that we're sort of calibrating our own expectations to make sure that not only do they align very closely to the state's expectations in terms of the new assessments, but also that they're calibrated to each other, so that when we look at that data for the students, that it's very reliable. So that's something that we have felt with, you know, we've had discussions about that with principals, with the coaches, that that really is what we're working on right now. Yeah, I mean, that's, I can go into a little bit more here at the end, but that, I think that's key. Yeah.
The other question I have when the English language arts, part of what's really hard to assess is the creativity piece. And that's something we're trying, that's, I consider vital. Mm-hmm. To our children's future. And so my question is whether the teachers see that encouraged and assessed through these tests, and whether they still have that leeway in their classrooms to be developing some of those unstandardizable skills that are going to serve our kids so well. So when we calibrate it to the test, my concern is I don't want to calibrate out the creativity,
right,
or calibrate
right.
out the opportunity to do a string journal, or calibrate out those things that in the end, when the jobs don't exist, the skills that are going to enable our kids to be able to rise to those challenges.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think the teachers would agree. I mean, their number one objective is that kids are loving that subject area. I mean, to take ELA, I mean, there's a big focus on writing, the different types of genre writing, you know, the narrative and the argumentative or the opinion writing and the informational writing, that there's different types of writing, and all are focused on, and we've been shifting to that, and that's right from the state standards. And so, no, I think kids really are enjoying these classes. And so I think we would agree that's not something we want to lose.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually, in my experience, key for kids to be performing well. On that, if they're not loving what they're doing, it's not going to work. Yeah,
I'm going to make a comment on that because I agree with you completely. I think that those kind of rich experiences lead to better results. They're not, you have to do one or the other. You can accomplish this goal through 90 minutes a day of kill and drill and fill out worksheets and fill out practice tests, or you can accomplish this goal the right way. I think it sounds like the commitment is to do it the right way.
Like when we talk about our focus on social emotional things, that yes, absolutely, our goal is for kids to reach high levels of achievement. But if kids are not coming in ready to learn, if there's other obstacles to them, that becomes astronomically more difficult. So the better that we as a system address those obstacles, kids then can be happier and enjoy their classes and learn what they need to learn. So,
yeah.
Mr. Lyon,
yeah, just. Dr. Doxa touched on it, and a little bit more clarity, but let's say at the elementary level, for English language arts, there would be a pretest in the beginning of the year. I'm pretty sure they do a test to determine their level.
It's usually, yeah, I mean, sometimes it's not a test, sometimes it's work samples, writing, it's, you know, writing samples and things, yeah.
Well, I think there's some clear cut. I could be wrong.
There's reading benchmarks.
The reading assessment as
yeah.
well?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I was actually referring to the reading assessment.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Thanks,
yeah.
Eric. So do we, you know, I think to me, you know, we're talking about common measures. The most important thing is where do they start and then where do they finish, which is much more valuable than a one-time test where kids could be sick that day, someone's absent.
Absolutely.
And doesn't take into consideration the levels that they start at and where they progress. So can we get that data at some point? I think it would be valuable for us to look at in terms of student progress, which is meaningful, as opposed to the one-time test.
Yeah, I mean, those are, I'll talk about it now. I had a slide later that addressed it. I feel like in many ways that's where we're at as a district in terms of, it's two things. One is making sure that the data that we're getting is calibrated and reliable. Secondly is, do we have the capacity to actually do what you've just said with, you know, without spending hours and hours and hours getting this in district form? We're able to do that. We have a data person now that started, Courtney, who started the
February,
who is outstanding, came as part of the grant, and so much of what she's doing is with the PBIS things, but she's just been, I mean, not only brilliant in the work that she's doing, but just works endlessly. And this was a conversation I was just having with her the other day, that we really need to make sure that, whether it's the reading benchmarks, even report card grade standards, that we should be very easily able to pull those, look at them for predictability to how kids are scoring on the state assessments, to make sure that we are aligned in that way. We've never been able to do that in the past. As long as I've, you know, I mean, it's easier and maybe at the secondary level where it's just about grades. So those are systems and things that we're putting in place to make sure. So some of it's software, manpower, consistency in how it's being input and collected across the districts. Instead of just being school-based or grade-level-based, where teachers are, you know, bringing their data on their laptops or on their pieces of paper, how are we able to pull it across the district so it's being able to be shared across schools also? So that's what we've been doing for the last several months to a year or so. And certainly Ms. Fogarty, our data person, has been excellent in helping us with that.
Just for further clarity, so is it, without putting any undue additional work on the classroom teachers, mm-hmm. couldn't we have the data expert look at some of this data and give us a better, you know, perspective on student achievement as opposed to just the, I mean, we have to go by this. This is what the state requires us, but I think from my standpoint, I'd like to see, you know, what really occurs during the course of the year.
No, I agree. And that's what we're putting in together and putting in place. For example, sometimes what we've been doing is trying to identify where we don't have the systems or the capacity in place to do that very conveniently. So, you know, I might say, let's focus on one particular grade level or one school's grade level, and let's see that data and say, no, so what would it take so that we're able to pull that from all five third grades across the district so that we can mix it, we can disaggregate it by teacher or subgroup, you know, whatever we need to be able to look at that and so that teachers are able to have conversations in meaningful ways. We haven't been able to do that in the past, and that's what we've been working on. So, I mean, yes, I agree with you. We need to do that. My hope is that much of that progress is being made this year, that by next year, you know, my goal would be that we're able, actually, even with the report card standards, to be able to say, we know that if a student, if we are saying a student is meeting or exceeding most of the standards in a particular content level, that we can accurately predict that that student will be scoring at a particular level, with some exceptions, because we know some, as you said, some kids just don't test well in those circumstances, or it's a bad day or whatever, but overall we should see a correlation.
And a lot more goes into the report card grade than just the tests.
Absolutely, so yeah.
That's
yeah.
not,
yeah.
you can't compare
yeah.
the two.
Yeah, and so I would always want to feel better about our own district data, but I still think we're getting there where we can feel that it's really reliable and valid, and also we still want to feel as if it's aligned and it correlates to the state, because that's a huge problem. You know, when a parent asks, you know, well, if there's that disconnect and a parent's child was scoring really high on report cards or on district assessments and then they didn't do so well on PARC, or vice versa, we should have a very good answer to that. And it might be, my hope is that it's the answer is about that individual child. I don't want to say, well, yeah, we had a huge percentage like that. That would be a problem. There may always be some individuals that that has to do, that that pertains to, but not everybody.
But I, just yeah. one more. Eric, so what grade levels do actually use that pre-assessment for reading?
All the grade levels.
All the grades do. So essentially we could then not just rely on third grade data, we could look at second grade data. Our grade data is that, you know, makes sense to...
Well, and there's no question...
I'm not saying do it all, I'm just saying spread yeah. it out.
Well, and I know Mr. Sprung will mention this probably when we get to the Eaton update, that even the third grade assessment data, it's not just about third grade. I mean, it's about K-3. So yeah, I mean, there's information we need to have probably by the end of second grade to know how ready are kids to really tackle third grade and the state assessment for the first time. That's what we're working on. Okay, so let's take a look at, same thing for math. So again, this is just looking at 2016 in purple compared to the green, which was last year, PARC. And again, this was actually in third grade math overall, even though there are some discrepancies from school to school. Overall, this was actually probably one of the bigger increases. 12-point jump there in the percentage of kids hitting levels 4 and 5 compared to last year, including a pretty significant jump in the level 5s, which is what we always like to see as well. Grade 4 is lower. You'll see when I get to the slides, especially in math, all the tests really, but when I look at the different years, grade 4 and grade 8, if I had to pick the two more challenging tests for kids, those are the two grade levels. I think the both of those grade levels, you know, this isn't to make excuses, because clearly we want the kids to be up there at the same numbers. But across the state, even when you look at it, the material starts to get more sophisticated at those particular levels. So again, fairly consistent between the last 2 years. We had a few more into the level 5, which was great, but, you know, shifted over from level 4 to level 5. Here's grade 5. Grade 6. Grade 7. Grade 8. And then also we had some of our students taking Algebra 1 in 8th grade. And I have a note here, so a couple things. First of all, again, it's the second year where 100% of the students that were placed into that pathway and completed Algebra 1 in 8th grade, so 100% of them received level 4 or 5. A really significant increase this year in the amount of level 5s, which we were really pleased with. So, and also we noticed, if I back up here one, even with the 8th grade math, fairly significant, I mean 7% more receive level 5 this time in that. So we've been having some discussions with some folks about this, not only our own curriculum leader here in math, but even looking at some of the data from other districts, to take a look to see if, you know, our pathways, our criteria is really aligned in a way that maximizes the number of students that can be able to do that. So we're in the process of looking at that. I mean, over, I think I have it on there, small print, over the last few years, we have been seeing an increase in students that are placing into this particular pathway. We were down, I think, a few years ago from 14%, moved up to 17% last year, and now 23% this year. And I think part of that also is that the kids are coming into sixth grade with a stronger foundation. So we have been seeing, and even the teachers, I think, notice that the kids are stronger coming into middle school, which I think is starting to do that, but I think it's then time for us to also even look at some of the criteria, because if our kids are being placed and they're getting really strong scores, even above what's, then maybe there's some room there that we need to look at. We certainly want to be giving every kid opportunity. And, you know, one of the things that we've looked at is, you know, our experience. I know this a couple years ago, when we were having discussions about the pathways, even through high school and so forth, we knew that many of the students that, before the standards changed, before the Algebra 1 course changed drastically, that didn't really correlate to the number of kids that were going on to 12th grade AP mm-hmm. calculus or whatever, that the attrition was huge in around 10th or 11th grade. We don't expect that to be the case now. I mean, this Algebra 1 course at high school is a very rigorous honors level course, and these students are still going. So we feel confident that those numbers that are prepared for high school, no matter what we do with the placement criteria, that they'll be very well prepared to succeed throughout without the attrition rates that we've had in the past. We wanted to make sure that we weren't throwing kids into a deeper end of the pool for the sake of a particular pathway when they aren't ready, because that's a sure way to make sure, I think, that they don't continue. It kind of gets back to what you were saying before about if a kid starts really hating that subject or not succeeding, that will kill off, the future. So this is promising to us, and we're looking at that.
Hey, could you go back one slide?
Yep.
Because I'm very happy to hear you say that, because I thought the exact same thing when I saw it. If you've got 100% of kids performing at that level, are there any kids who aren't in that level who maybe should be? And sure. When you see 10% of the other kids performing at level 5, I globbed onto that and said, I wonder about that 10% of kids. Maybe some group of them, it would seem to me, could be accessing that higher level math. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. How are you going to go about looking at, I have two questions. One is, how are you going to go about looking at changing the parameter or requirements for that access to that class? But my second is, have you seen an increase in the number this year?
Yeah,
oh,
so
sorry,
this year, even though they haven't taken the eighth grade yet,
data.
It's really tiny.
Yeah.
It's 23%. And I'm assuming even if we did nothing, it would make go up
seriously,
again.
I can't read it. I'm getting old. Yeah.
So 14 to 17 to 23.
So that's the percentage of kids accessing that class.
So
you are seeing an increase.
To this year.
You are.
Yeah. So even without changing the criteria, that's been changed.
So you've probably had to add sections.
Yes. So both middle schools right now, I believe, have two sections.
That's really good news.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So we're looking at that. We're also looking, to get to the point about the kids. I mean, we can actually then go to, obviously I can't present it, in public, but we can look at the specific kiddos who are scoring the 5 and how did they score in placement thing, all of that sort of things. We're looking at other districts too, because again, I'm not necessarily impressed with just the percentage of kids that are in algebra, but if they are in that, and how are they doing? I've talked to districts that have felt, just as we have, a lot of community pressure that they're picking sort of percentages. Mm-hmm. And we have said, we want the percentage to go up too, but we want it to be about readiness, not just about a percentage that we feel is just kind of keeps people happy. Because sometimes the unhappiness doesn't occur until 3 or 4 years down the road, and we don't want that to happen either. So those are the things that we're looking at right now.
Mrs. Webb? Yeah, my question was, I actually was at a couple PTO meetings where the schools were, elementary schools were presenting some of the PARC results, and so one of my questions was, how are the schools looking at where they're focusing? Are the principals just looking at sort of their own data set, or are they sort of looking at the whole data set? Because it's interesting when you look at the whole data set, if you look at all the PARC math and you just sort of circle the things that are less than 70 in 4 and 5, it tells you something. But if you're just looking at, your own data for your own school, what things are going to stand out to you might be different. So I'm just sort of wondering, and in this area, there's sort of probably some interesting things to look at between Coolidge and Parker.
Absolutely. Well, especially in 8th grade.
I mean,
I can say it, because I know that each school has talked about it. Staff mm-hmm. from both schools together have looked at that there's some differences that seem to be happening in 8th grade. And sometimes that's about even how teachers are working together. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it could be lots of different things, but they've been having those discussions. I looked at, by the way, these two slides here, because I kind of stopped before I finished the whole math section. But this, like you said, made me think of it when you said below 70. So this is just students, 8th grade students taking the 8th grade math assessment.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, these are still eighth grade students, but those are the number of students that were taking that. So I have a slide that combines them, and I think the total is about 70% are meeting or exceeding when you combine those, which the state doesn't give us, but we tried to make sure that we had that right. So here is the overall cumulative slide that the state always looks at grades 3 through 8 collectively, the percentage of students at each level. And again, in most cases, even though I'm not content yet by any stretch of the imagination, to see little bits of improvement in many of these, I think were promising. Okay, so here's the ones, as I did in ELA, but I think it was interesting, I was eager to look at this with math because of the way the state also transitioned. So I put in a in small. I have the opposite. I can't see when it's close. I can't see when it's far. So I put in small print how the state transitioned, because that's why I really wanted to look at this. And I think it's a little less pronounced in third grade than others. But so around 2012, we began sort of shifting, knowing that the state was shifting their standards as well. But in 2012, the MCAS was still assessing the old, or the previous 2000, they called it the 2000-2004 standards, because they're from 2000, but I think 2004, they did some tweaks, did some changes. In 2013 then, they were still focusing, they said they started to assess the new 2011 standards, but really focused on the standards that connected to the old ones, knowing that schools were still transitioning. In 2014 then, they for the first time said, okay, this one now is really just about the new standards, the 2011 standards, but it was still with MCAS, I called it MCAS 1.0, just knowing now that they're, I don't know what it's gonna become, assuming it'll just be MCAS, but we'll know it as MCAS 2.0. And then 2015 was still, of course, the new standards, but then it was a new assessment that, as the state told everyone, was designed to be a more rigorous assessment, but also because it was really trying to capture and incorporate those practice standards, the math practice standards, that it really was, you know, the ability to, you know, work through problems, persevere through them, math thinking. So to go through then this series for the different grade levels, I was pleased when I see now going through that transition when things start to sort of dip and come back up again, to see if we can get back up to those sort of 2013, 2012 levels and then beyond. So here it is in grade 3. Grade 4, again, starting to see some of that overall lower, but even historically has been lower. I think the test is materials a little bit more difficult. Grade 6, grade 7, and grade 8. And so yeah, the 2015, so it's about, so it's 70% now. Because this slide, we combine both the algebra and the eighth grade math. Okay. Anything else on math before I go to growth? Yeah.
I just had one quick question going back to the, but you don't have to go back to the slide.
Okay.
The algebra one. I'm just curious, you know, obviously 100% from the students in those classes. Have any students ever tested in and dropped down at the beginning of the year? Just curious how that.
You know, I'd have to double check. I think that has happened, but I don't believe it's happened in eighth grade because it's a 2-year sequence. So essentially, students are being placed near the end of sixth grade. And so essentially then they go into a course that we call Math 7-8, which is essentially 2 years of standards in 1 year. So I think it has happened.
At the end of seventh.
Yeah, in seventh grade.
But not in eighth.
During
seventh.
But they started
that
algebra.
I think once they get into
then
eighth grade, they've stayed in there. Okay. But I'll check on that, but I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, before we go on to the growth, so I just sort of still have a little bit of a question about tell the two elementary principals, I know I looked at the Josh Wheaton slider to address certain things, but how the principals approach in general, not like specifically, but approach the data to decide, you know, how they look at the data for their school to understand what they're going to focus on. And I just, I mean, we looked at the, we saw the district data, right, this data the day, you know, the Monday morning before, you know, the information was published. I'm just kind of, I just want to get a sense of context. It's so much data, but are the individual schools looking at it in the context of the overall district to help determine where do I focus, or you just, I don't know.
Yeah, I think you have to do both. I think you have to look at the district scores and how your school sort of fits in, because you want to make sure you're in alignment or at least in comparison to a reasonable level where the district seems to be scoring. You also want to look historically. So over time, is your school continuing to make progress, or do you find that you're falling behind? And that might be just individual school looking from one year to the next. And then you want to look not just at the achievement side, but also the growth side. So are your continuing to show growth, even though maybe your scores started lower or your scores started higher, you still want to see growth. So you could have some really high achievement scores, but if your growth is falling, that might send a different picture. So I think you have to look at all of it. We also look at the comparison towns. So we look from one town to the next. So certainly for me at Josh Wheaton, that's an important thing to look at when you start to say, all right, what other schools were in a similar situation to Josh Wheaton? Are there other schools that we should be modeling practices from? So those are all things that are coming to that conversation.
Thank you.
So speaking of growth, let's go ahead and take a look at that. And I think these are very similar, some cases the same that the explanation slides as I had in the past. But just as you've said, I mean, clearly we want to look at the achievement, the assessment scores themselves, the levels 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or proficient or advanced, are the levels of achievement. And that tells us essentially, are the students, that particular student or the group of students showing proficiency at what levels. But growth indicates a change in an individual student's progress from one year to the next. And it does that by looking at how a student has improved more or less with the identified academic peers from the past. In other words, students who have scored similarly had prior scores in the past year. The state defines moderate or expected growth to be between the 40th to 60th percentile. 50 would be straight up, that's sort of where most of the kids have grown in that particular cohort. Low growth then obviously would be below 40th percentile, and high growth above the 60th percentile. They gave an example there from the state of a student, Mary. I was moving from fifth to sixth grade, but she improved more than 65% of her academic peers that they've identified, that her SGP, or student growth percentile, would be 65. It's important to remember that growth is distinct from achievement, very much like you're talking about with the high school LA, that it's very possible to have very high achievement and low growth, or very high growth and low achievement. That they're compared only to their statewide academic peers that have scored similarly, not to all students statewide, and that each one of these SGPs are subject, grade, or year specific. So it's possible, in other words, to have a different growth percentile in different subject areas. I mean, as Mr. Sprung was implying, I mean, this is a very important thing for us to look at, obviously. I remember, I forget how many years ago it was when our state, I think I've said this before, but when our state started incorporating growth and trying to measure that, I felt as a teacher, I think I was a principal at the time, but I felt as a teacher that was always something that felt sort of fundamentally unfair to me as an educator. That certainly, you know, I don't mean to be minimizing achievement, but I also know, especially for students who struggle, that's not seeing the complete picture, that I always felt that as a teacher, my sort of solemn goal was, you know, we inherit students each year and I need to determine where are they and they need to make at least a good solid year's growth. As a matter of fact, if it's a student who's struggling, at some point between elementary and high school, they're going to be needing to make increments of even more than a year's growth. And that's going to happen at different times. And I know that that even as an emotional thing for educators, for families, for students, when students are not quite clearing that bar. But that's why I think it's important as a school system to look at how does it happen from, you know, third grade to 12th grade or 10th grade or whatever the state. Because for many kids it is happening. It just happens at different times. And so even though it's a very difficult thing to sort of measure and capture, I thought it more closely mirrored the mission that I think that every single individual teacher has, which is I might have kids that are working really hard and is making great progress and I'm feeling effective as a teacher, but I know there's no way they're going to clear that particular bar set that year, but my hope is I'm preparing them for at some point they will end up clearing that bar down the road. So obviously that's something we want to be looking at. So here's a table I started putting together. Started looking at it this way, I think it was last year, so I wanted to add to it. So it kind of gives a historical perspective. So again, keeping in mind that we want all of our SGPs in all the different grade levels, all the different content areas where growth is able to be measured by the state, to be in that 40 to 60 range at least. Above 60 would be considered high growth. And this year in 2016, every single one of them were. Matter of fact, there were three that were in the high growth range, which we are very pleased about. You might notice that science is not listed on there because there are several years in between, it's difficult for them to get accurate. Right? Mm-hmm. So these are the content areas, the English and math, where they have data every single year, where they're able to identify the like cohort and get pretty accurate measurements on growth statewide. Second, just to look at those. Yeah, you can see, for instance, even when I look at, you know, math, I'm looking at sixth grade math, seventh grade math.
These are MCAS to PARC, too, right?
They are. Yeah. So 15 and 16 were PARC,
mm-hmm.
And then before was.
That
was something I think we talked about, because I even brought that up with the state when people would ask, well, it's a different test now, so it certainly does, but they said, well, but when you're measuring growth, it's always a different test, because you're looking at the cohort from the, you know, if it's a fourth grader, you're looking at the third grade test, and they're very different tests, even though it was still MCAS.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're really just looking at how did students score on whatever test they were giving before to now the new test. And then here, this is always my favorite one to create, because the state kind of looks at it this way for the high school, and I wanted to put on all of the different grade levels. So in this sort of plot here, kind of gives you the different quadrants. So I've got sort of two thin green lines that says, you know, the 40th to 60th percentile, the 50th is right up there. So if I'm looking at the upper ones, we're talking about I can't see. So the percent proficient or higher is on the left axis, the vertical axis there. And along the bottom is the median SGP, or student growth percentile. So if the goal is obviously to go up as high as you can in achievement and as far over to the right as you can in growth, to at least be in the middle or beyond, you want to be into, you know, to the right of that square, into the upper right quadrant as much as possible. So you can see that grade 10 is the larger sort of light blue, and we had talked about before that because they're practically off the chart there in terms of achievement at the 99th percentile, the fact that they're still, I forget what it was, 47, I forget what it went there, but still considered to be in the moderate range for growth, and all of the other grades were moderate, or even one of them was touching there into the higher. That's ELA. Here's what it looks like for math. Mm-hmm.
Craig, can I ask a question going back to once that grade 10 growth thing again? There's something I'm not quite understanding. So if that, oh, you go one over, the blue bubble.
The oh, okay, yep.
Big blue
yep.
bubble.
Should be over.
So the way I understand it is basically we looked at all those kids who scored so well in 10th grade ELA mm-hmm. and look back to, I mean, obviously a massive computer algorithm did this, not a human, but look back and said, who were those kids in 8th grade? And who scored like them? And how did they do in 10th grade, right? And then I'm going to pair. So what I'm wondering is everybody in the 99th or 100 percentile lower growth? Because it would seem to me that there should be, the way you described it, 65% is the 65. So if we have 47, presumably there are kids who scored 99, 100 percentile who do have high growth. Because they can't all have 47%. There's got to be a 48, a 49, a 60.
That's the median.
Okay.
So there are kids higher and there are kids lower.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
So what I'm trying to square that with is the, well, once you get to a certain high level of achievement, nobody has high growth. It seems like some would.
Individual students do, absolutely.
Okay.
This is the median score for the entire 10th grade.
I was just looking to remind myself. So last year, for instance,
okay.
ELA was 98.
The median is, that's that percentage
percent.
Is individual student. That
yeah.
helped me. Thank you very much, Dr. Daugherty. That helped. That's what I couldn't wrap my head around. Thank you.
Anything else? I wanted to take a few more minutes to take a look at the high need subgroup compared to the aggregate all student group as well. So several slides, or sort of series of slides here. So first of all, I wanted to take a look at, and again, this is where it gets to be a little bit difficult because it's almost, I don't want to say it's apples and oranges, but because the high school versus the other in two different types of tests, mm-hmm. and also two, not only two different types of tests, but one is a different type of test that has already shifted to different standards, and so I don't mean to take anything away from the high school at all because I think it's doing excellent job and getting great results, but I also think that I needed to separate it out. There was no way to combine the data, because mm-hmm. what I'm saying. So we're seeing here, so in the purple in each one of these is the high needs subgroup, and again, the high needs is students with disabilities, economically challenged, or English language learners, okay? And the reason that, obviously, that we wanna be looking at that, several reasons, but one, obviously, because those are the kids that oftentimes are struggling, and we need to make sure that we're servicing well. Also, even with the level 3 issue, the state has designated to put a focus on the high needs group. So on the left is the 2015. On the right side there is 2016 for both the high school MCAS, first of all. This is ELA, and then the grade 3 through 8 PARC. And then I wanted to look at the same type of thing, but instead of the percentage proficient or advanced, take a look at the difference in terms of median SGP, the growth, which actually was a little more encouraging to me to see, again, not content at all in terms of achievement, but to see that the growth is happening there in the moderate range. It's good.
Mm-hmm. I think that's very encouraging. Back to the last slide, though. Mm-hmm. How do you get from the 44 and 40 percent to the 90, 89s and 90s?
So I'll look,
because
when I did these the last several days, I do have a slide coming up that I decided when I did that, I had the same question for
okay.
myself, that I thought I visually wanted to see it, grades 3, 4, 5, 6, what it looked like this year. So we'll look at that in a sec, and we can
okay.
talk a little bit about that. And maybe it'll answer your question, maybe it won't. Okay, so that was ELA. Let's take a look at math. So again, 2015 on the left, 2016 on the right. And again, I think it's even more pronounced in math. I say there I'm sort of, again, generally pleased with the aggregate progress that we're making towards proficiency for all students. Not content yet, but some progress is being made to more historical marks, but not happy with the high need subgroup yet at all.
Mm-hmm.
Again, though, when I look at it, when I pulled it out to take a look at the median SGP, encouraging. So then here's the slide, starting with ELA that I was just referring to, that Mrs. Webb, you talked about. So I decided, well, let me take a look at this year, because I kind of wanted to see how it tends to progress over the, I mean, this is just one snapshot this particular year. It could look a little bit different each year. For my own benefit, I was looking at several years. There's some variation, but overall, it was somewhat similar. Again, it's difficult because the tests, it's like the game keeps changing, has changed a little bit each year in terms of the type of assessment. This kind of gives you a view. This is ELA, grade 3, 4, 5, sort of the, so I'm looking at the differential and how it tends to get a little bit closer in middle school and the big jump in high school. Here is what this year looked like in math. This was interesting to me because also, and these are discussions we're having too, and we were talking about it before, how we're grouping kids, placing kids. There's different levels in those two grades in 7th and 8th grade, and how many high needs kids probably tend to be in particular levels. And it's, so we're looking at ways to address that, because clearly that was something that jumped out to me, that it didn't seem to mirror what's happening in ELA.
Is this a pattern that you see in other communities where there's a jump at the high school level?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I feel like the whole level one, I've seen other communities where most of the schools are level two, but the high school's a level one. So I feel like this is something that isn't just Reading specific.
Yeah. What is that developmental, development of the students also?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's primarily the developmental level of the students, but also even the test itself. I think it's just tends to be a little bit different, and developmentally, but the kids can handle it. So, but I think that's been the case since the state testing began.
Some of you've been looking at it. It's just very stark. It's very stark when you look at it this way. That how do you get from, you know, the 30s or 40s in terms of achievement level, you know, 40 to 70 or higher in 2 years over the course of really ninth and year and a half.
Again, one of the ways that I like to look at it, that, you know, and I have the same conversations with teachers, is that I think it's very important for a system, especially a size district like ours, is to take the perspective of that vertical look, because it kind of works both ways. You can't take too much credit in the now, but you also don't want to beat yourself up too much with the now, because it's a vertical progression. I say it's very important for each of us at each grade level. I've been calling it where we are in the relay race, sort of how we take the baton from the person before us and then pass it on to the next. And our goal is to make sure as a system that all of our students are making it over that bar. But we just know, because of human development, it's gonna happen in different ways at different times. But as a team, we have to be working vertically to make sure that all of them are, and that we're providing interventions along the way to help them do that.
And your point about the high need subgroups is particularly noticeable, but it's the all students too, go from 60s and 70s to 93. I mean, they're both experiencing enormous jumps.
It's more dramatic, and it makes you just sort of say, you might look at like sort of the 32 and say, well, there are things that we should be doing here. We have to bring that up. But at the same time, you have to look at it and say, well, yeah, maybe there are some things that we need to be doing here to bring that up, but maybe we just have to recognize that there's other things and programs and supports and that are happening, you know, the year after that are what we need to do. So I it's just an interesting data set in terms of trying to understand where you put your focus.
Right. You also have to remember, though, that what you're looking at, grade 10 is the MCAS,
yes,
which is a paper and pencil test. You're not able to ask the same types of questions, mm-hmm, as you are with an interactive online test like the PARC.
Mm-hmm.
So you're really comparing, you really shouldn't be comparing the grade 10 with the 6-7, because it's two different tests.
Right, but what was that? Did we not see that kind of a jump previously with when we were just like all MCAS?
We did, but I think it's a little bit different. Yeah, it's
oh,
right
it's
now.
I think
the middle's probably a little bit lower
okay.
than it used
okay.
to be. But yeah, it was always there. And that's something too, I mean, I've got a bullet in an upcoming slide, but the high school, we've had discussions. I mean, they're already beginning their preparation, knowing that the assessment's going to be changing in the next few years at the high school level.
Right.
Oh, Mrs. Joyce.
And although that looks great, I don't mean to burst the bubble just a little bit, but my understanding is that, to your point, you said the test in 10th grade is different, mm-hmm. and it is going from PARC to MCAS, but also, too, it's a graduation requirement. Isn't the test a little bit less difficult? Mm-hmm. So that, mm-hmm. I mean, isn't that, I've historically heard that.
Yeah, I mean, I think they place the bar in a different way in terms to satisfy the graduation requirement. Yeah, I mean, I said I've long thought, I think 4th and 8th grade, in terms of the developmental level of students with the sophistication of the stuff they're being presented, are very challenging times. I think several things happen. The state makes some adjustment probably for the requirements, but also the developmentally. You know, I was a middle school teacher, and I love students coming back to me in high school that might have struggled in middle school, telling me how they're doing well now, you know, and grateful to the foundation that they had. And you just see that happen with many kids. No, I think, you know, again, I feel bad because I don't want to take away from, because I think the high school's been making tremendous progress, but a fairer look, if we just wanted to look at the high school, would be just to look at the high school historically. You know, I mean, one of the slides, I think I failed to mention it, but even the math SGP, I think, is the highest SGP
yes.
that they've had yeah. since the
right.
state started this,
yeah.
Which is really something to be proud of, I think. And even the fact that that differential between the high needs group and the all students, I think, is why they moved back up from level 2 to level 1. So that's, I mean, that's to the credit of the teachers who are really focusing on that data and doing the hard work to make that happen.
State average, though, on that. Advanced and proficient is 78 in math for MCAS 10th grade, so it is that's considerably higher than the state average.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, and to your point, just
yeah.
another bit of positive news, the percentage of high school students in ELA performing advanced for the last 2 years is significantly
mm-hmm.
higher
mm-hmm.
than it was, and that is not growth, that is a straight,
mm-hmm.
this
yeah.
is the
just,
standard,
absolutely.
And that is, I mean,
yeah.
that's worthy of noting.
Right.
That is a significant jump.
Yeah. So I do want to get over and pass it along to Mr. Sprung to kind of give an update, but I mean, several things. We've kind of been talking about it as we move along. But moving forward, I said, you know, first there, we continue to use these results at all levels, district, school, and even student level, to identify our strengths and weaknesses, make adjustments where necessary, provide interventions where we need to for particular kids. We are not getting as much released information from the PARC as we might be getting from the, but we are getting some, and so we want to use all of that and samples. Collaborating with other districts also. You know, I was mentioning and looking at the data about algebra, even in some of the professional development and things that we've been doing. We've been, an example, for instance, our literacy coach, Tricia Stodden, we collaborated with North Andover to provide PD for teachers about writing, and it was just excellent, got great feedback from teachers, but really sort of working together as districts, especially when resources are limited, the sort of joining forces where we have some similar needs or similar things that we're trying to provide to teachers. I already talked about, you know, improving the common assessments and our ability to analyze data in a more efficient means, I think is huge. That's a particular goal for this year. We're putting a lot of focus, especially at the elementary level, in reading, writing, and math to have really good data that can easily be pulled forth and take a look at. I talked about calibrating our expectations and standards. I mean, that's a whole nother sort of challenge to sort of increase that capacity to get good, reliable reports. And I mentioned there even our report cards. Working with all building administrators also, we've had discussions and walkthroughs together to sort of calibrate our own expectations for instruction, and the type of feedback that we'd be giving to support teachers. What we're looking for instance, in a math class in a particular grade level, or in an ELA class at a particular grade level, or whatever subject. And looking at all possible data. I mean, I talked about, you know, our data coach and so forth. Everything that we have, whether it's, you know, discipline referrals, student attendance, we're looking at. And that was one thing I know Mr. Sprung will mention. He mentioned in his presentation to that we decide, oh, you know, this actually is an area that's fairly easy for us to pull and look at and to correlate how many absences in a particular school. So like for students that have 10 or more absences, which is equivalent of 2 weeks or more time, and to correlate that to say, okay, so if there's a particular high number, how did that correlate with the number of those students, how many of those students were high needs? How many of those were the exact students that did not meet expectations on the park? And there's correlations there. And so that's something, I mean, it's difficult, but those are conversations that schools, we can have. But first of all, on the school side, we want to work to create, you know, inviting and engaging positive classroom experiences where kids are eager and want to be there every day. But then we also want to work with families to make sure that they're able to do everything that they can do to make sure their kids are attending, and also to I just lost my train of thought.
Happens to me all the time. Don't worry about it.
Happens. Getting that time.
Been there, done that.
We've been presenting for a long time. Yeah. So you get a pass.
But that was interesting data for us to look at. I mean, that correlation. I mean, clearly there are some examples where, you know, there was a injury or longer illness or something. But, you know, if there's single absences and things, you know, what's causing that? Oh, I know what I wanted to say is to help the parents realize, because sometimes you're not noticing how that does have a correlation, that these are the students that, you know, it's very difficult to miss 2 weeks or 3 weeks of instruction and make that up, especially if you struggle. And so that's not about blame or point. It's just about sharing this information, having these discussions, so that we're working on both sides to do everything we can for those particular kids. Okay, so looking ahead, I mean, we already know I've been talking about MCAS 2.0. So we are scheduled to participate in that online assessment spring 2017 for ELA and math grades 3 through 8. I said we're expecting that it will be very similar to PARC in regards to the substance. What we are being told in terms of the high school requirement, that the MCAS for math and ELA will continue for high school, most likely through the class of 2020. I believe the Board of Education, I don't think they voted yet this month. I thought they were
going
to vote
doing
in October.
In October, yeah.
So I don't think they've done it yet.
Tomorrow night.
So maybe it's
this
week.
Tomorrow night.
So they need to determine that. Also, they're going to determine how they're going to be transitioning to the new standards for 20. They think they're going to start assessing the new science standards for high school in 2018, 2019, but the board has not officially voted on that yet. The state has also said that all schools, so it would be basically schools that serve grades 3 through 8, are held harmless in terms of accountability determination, which means you can move up but you can't move down because they realize that the test is changing, which they did for PARC. I took some things there from the state website that I thought were interesting as well, and this is sort of how they're transitioning. We talked about how they did it for ELA and math. This is how they have announced they're doing it for science. Essentially, this year they are still assessing the 2001-2006 standards in both grades 5 and 8. And they say there on the site that it's a multi-year test, that grade 5 is assessing standards in grades 3, 4, and 5, and grade 8 is assessing grades 6, 7, 8. Then they're saying in 2017-18, they are going to assess the overlapping standards between the 2001 and 2016, and then fully transitioned where they are completely assessing the new standards in 2019. most of these, I think we've already said, I think it's going to be very similar. I mean, overall, we've said 32, some of these I included in the update to the community, 32 of the 36 median student growth percentiles, and there's 36, not just the ones I included here, but school by school,
right,
even. So 32 of them represented either improvement or that at least they're all falling in the moderate or high range. Overall, again, in looking at all of them, 29 of the 44 PROC assessments and 5 out of the 10 MCAS assessments showed improvement. 15 of the 30 composite performance indices, CPI and ELA and math for the elementary schools represented an improvement over last year. CPI is the measure that used to say the school or the subgroup making its way gradually towards all proficiency by 2017, which I'm assuming that the state, because we're hitting 2017, is probably going to redo their accountability formula. We'll see, but there's some information about that on their website as well. RMHS, as we mentioned, moved from level 2 to level 1. I know Mr. Sprung's going to talk about Joshua Eaton, remains classified as level 3. Although I do have a note there, and I put this in the update to the community too, because DESC indicated a focus on the high needs subgroup, and the high needs CPI, the PPI, the Cumulative Progress Performance Index, for just looking at Eaton, has gone up from 36 to 56 to 61 in the last 3 years. Still not where we want it to be, but there's still progress to be made. We're in there, so I want to hand it over to Mr. Sprung to talk a little bit about Eaton.
Thank you. I'm going to walk through some information about Josh Wheaton. You'll see the data presentation was primarily done by Craig, but when I had my school presentation, I certainly walked through with the staff as well as with the community the Josh Wheaton specific data that certainly is instrumental in guiding a lot of the information that I'm going to share with you tonight, just creating the plan and the direction that the school is going to be going in. And I'll start just looking at the slide behind me, the areas that we have looked at when it comes to what are some factors that impact the results. And so you'll see there's certainly a large number of areas that I have to focus on and I have to look at, and trying to make sure that each one of these areas are looked at, studied, and if there's data behind them, analyzed to make sure that we're focusing our attendance, our kind of objectives in the right way. And attendance is obviously one of those things you'll see behind us. So we do look at student attendance. What is the impact of student attendance on test scores? We talked a lot in our building about typing, so looking at third grade. Certainly the third grade scores at Josh Wheaton are different than the scores at the other schools in third grade. So are there other things in this district that they're doing as they're preparing kids in third grade for the state assessments? And is typing one of the things that we need to look at in terms of the timing and the rigor as well as the practice that we're providing for students? We are looking at instruction from grades K through 5, and I think one of the things that when you look at a test that's only grades 3, 4, and 5, sometimes too much attention might get focused on the one grade that's failing, and there's actually a historical component that needs to get looked at. So we've looked at data, and Gary mentioned reading data, but we also look at the writing data and math data starting back in kindergarten. And what are the historical trends that we're finding with that group of students starting in kindergarten? What do the reading scores look like? What does the writing samples look like? How has their math performance impacted them? So when they got to third grade, did we have a good understanding of what were the factors that led to the scores in third grade? Did we know what those things that were coming to us? And how are we preparing our students, and what type of interventions we're providing? And we looked at, are the interventions that we're doing starting in kindergarten really yielding the results that we want to? That includes our Title I support, and as well as just overall expectations in the classroom. We're a high needs area is certainly our focus, but you'll see when you look at the scores, this is not just a high needs conversation. It needs to be about instruction starting in kindergarten. Are we having the same high expectations for all our students, and are we providing them the opportunities and the interventions and the high expectations that we want in order for us to achieve success? So you'll see that all of the things that are listed here have to be factored in to student test scores, and we are looking at all of these areas as things we need to continue to improve and continue to work on as we go through the data collection and data analysis. So I want to talk, when we talk about schools, I think sometimes we get really lost in data analysis, and I think sometimes we forget that we are schools, and we mentioned tonight talking about social emotional learning. And what are all the other things that schools need to recognize that are good and positive? And we certainly have taken a very serious look at our PARC data, and we know as a school we want to continue to improve, but we have a lot of success over the past year, and there's been a great community behind that success, and there's a lot of teachers that work hard and do want to see great things for students and really are invested in this work with the students. And you'll see behind me a list of things that really show that teachers and community are working together, and we have a lot of things that we can be proud of. And so we take our work seriously, we take improving our PARC data seriously, but we also want to say there are some things that we did well, and there are some things that we can say these are successes when the parents and the staff and the school come together. And the growth scores are a part of that. So you'll see our growth scores for ELA and math, so that's looking at our fourth and fifth graders. Certainly we have success there, as well as our high needs growth scores were a success for our school, and I think that's something to be proud of. And it's been a big shift in the culture at Josh Wheaton, knowing that there's this partnership with parents and with the school, and I really feel that that's leading us in the right direction as we continue to grow, just in terms of our school as well as with academic achievement. So we've identified four areas where we need to focus our energy and our support in order to improve the results in grades K through five, and certainly third grade being an area of focus. I'm just gonna highlight a few of these because you can certainly read them behind me, but we have started today, actually was the first day for our full-time team chairperson. We recognize our high needs population is an area for improvement, and our special education population is a big part of that high needs subgroup. So we have a full-time special education chairperson in our building who's going to be spending time with me looking at our special education instruction, looking at our program, looking at IEP goals and benchmarks, making sure that group of teachers is adequately supported so they ultimately can support the students. And also open up the lines of communication with parents so they feel that they're having appropriate support for them, and we are further gaining growth for our high needs population and specifically our special education students. And they're gonna be meeting on a monthly basis, and that was something I wasn't able to do because I'm having data conversations with our staff, but when you have someone who's dedicated for special education staff and special education students, they can have regular meetings to determine effective progress for the students that are part of our special education population. As far as interventions go, we're looking at what types of interventions we provide. So we have Title I as well as our reading specialists that provide interventions, but we have looked at what are some research-based interventions that can add or be enhanced to the school environment. So the Fountas Pinnell has a research-based intervention program that we're gonna be using. Certainly the Lexia program is a program that we've used in the past and will continue to use. And we're also looking at the Mahesh Sharma model of what types of interventions are gonna be necessary to help build basic skills for our students in the area of mathematics. We want students to have access to grade level curriculum, but a lot of the students that we're finding that have struggled on the PARC test don't have the basic skills, and they need some filling of the gaps in terms of their knowledge. And without that, those gap-filling opportunities, we're gonna continue to see those students struggle. So we're starting actually in kindergarten, first grade, and building in some of those interventions, and then we're also providing interventions after the school day as well. So we're gonna have an after-school program that's gonna focus on students in third, fourth, and fifth grade, helping them gain some knowledge as well, backfilling some of those basic skills that may be missing.
That's a question.
the after-school program, is that teachers, or is that like a, I was going to say friends of Eaton?
It'll be, it's teachers. So we're paying the teachers to stay after and work with the students, and we're identifying those students based on the data and the scores that they came in with. Just talking a little bit about the data side of the conversations that need to happen within the building, we need to have a more focused conversation in our buildings, and that are regular conversations around data, and putting in individual plans for students. We talk very globally about intervention strategies that we do for students, but each individual student that is struggling, we're going to have intervention plans for them. As I talked to the principal in Melrose, as well as other principals that have been level three and have moved to level one, they find that putting in individual plans for students that need to make growth is really a key to the success of moving kids through the levels. As you know, with PARG, growth is a big factor that they look at when it comes to the scores. So we have to make sure individual plans are put into place for all the students that need them. And then what is our practice testing opportunities look like in third grade, and how are we using that data to better understand, are the kids ready to take the test? So in third grade, we're going to be collecting the PARG practice test that those kids are involved with, getting an understanding of how they're performing, what are their strengths, what are the areas that they need to continue to improve, and that can help us target our interventions. We have to be cognizant that we don't want to over-test kids. You don't want to just teach to the test, but we also want to have as many predictors as we can when it comes to having an understanding of what that's going to look like for them when it comes to take the test in March and May this year. So those are things we are going to put in place with, and trying to strike the balance of continuing to teach, yet having a good understanding of how they are preparing them to take that type of test.
I just wanted to clarify, so when you said you're going to put individualized plans for the students, are you referring to their IEP or something different?
So these are not necessarily IEP plans.
Right, that's what I was thinking.
But for students, we've identified them as a level three, and we identified this as a particular part of the test that they struggled with, then we put in a specific intervention for that student that will
help.
So
it could be a student who isn't on an IEP.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
So we should maybe call that something different. Or
right. Rather than an individualized education plan, we get to
serious.
Individual learning
plan.
Individual learning
yeah.
plan is
yeah.
what
yeah.
it is.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's a good point. Yep.
Just to follow up on that, so then doesn't that sort of dovetail with some of that MTSS work, the
right.
tier, it's like the tier two supports,
correct.
Right?
Right.
So it's right in
yep.
with that.
Yeah.
As long as we continue to have the resources to do that.
Right. And I think a big part of that, and so having regular conversations certainly with these three support people here that are here guiding and supporting the process. So when we started having these conversations probably about a month ago, and we said, look, these, as a school, what do we need to continue to show the teachers we support them, because we want them to know that they're supported, but also create a sense of urgency in that the instruction that's happening in the building and the interventions and supports for students in the building needs to be at the forefront of all our conversations. And so Craig, John, and Carolyn have said, what resources and supports do you need? So we've looked at the specific intervention programs. We talked about the team chair. We talked about the after-school program. And so all of those things are going to continue to be focus of our conversations. What types of trainings do our staff need in order to make sure that they can do the work that they do? Who do they need to visit in other schools or in other districts in order to allow them opportunities where they can continue to learn, so ultimately they're implementing the appropriate curriculum and instruction and having the high standards that we want them to have? And so those are the things that the four of us are going to continue to work on together. So in the final step of the process of conversations that have happened over the past month, certainly the district goals come to the forefront of those conversations, and then an individual school goal or school goals that we have, and meeting the academic needs of all students and making sure we're closing the achievement gap. And all of the work that was listed on the previous slides fits under that category. We have to be very targeted and very strategic about how we're supporting teachers and students to make sure we can continue to close that gap. We made great strides last year in terms of communication, but it's still a goal that we as a school want to have because the parents are part of this process. We want parents to know that we need their help in terms of how we can continue to support their students. We found that the attendance rate of students, so students who had 10 or more absences, had a higher likelihood of struggling on the test. So what are the ways that we can help those students and we can make sure that students have access to the instruction that they need, and then we can be a team and a partnership with this work. So those are the things in a nutshell of kind of what this is going to look like. We have a lot of work to do. I'm very impressed with the teachers. They all have all taken a very serious approach to the work that needs to get done. When they see the data and they see that our school is not performing the way, you know, based on as much hard work as they're putting in, and you don't get the results, that's upsetting and disappointing to them, and they want to continue to improve, and they want to see positive results for our school. And so they're willing and committed to this effort with me. So I'm confident that that will continue to happen. Is there anything else you wanted to add about? So these are just an additional slide with data.
Yeah, so we'll post the PDF of this whole PowerPoint slide deck online, and so I decided to include the links there as we do every year in case people also want to go in. And the bottom one is the district overview, but I also provided the link for each individual school. If community members were not able to get to their individual school presentation or this one, they can actually kind of look into more detail at the accountability data, the scores for each grade level, the subgroups, and so forth. It's all there on the DESE website.
Can I just make one comment related? Can you flip back just to the goal slide? So this is part of the November 7th piece that you haven't seen yet, but we've focused, what you saw in the four slides that Eric presented is what every school is doing, only at varying degrees. So each school, and I think this is where you were going earlier, is that each school has identified where are their gaps in terms of the data and for their school, and they're focusing their school improvement plans, their principal goals, their teacher goals on the areas that they need to focus on as a school. So what you've heard tonight is what Joshua Eaton is doing based on the data that they have and the information that they have and how it aligns to the, we have one district goal this year, and that's the district goal with four focus areas, and the four focus areas are, you can see there, literacy, math, social emotional learning, and eliminating the achievement gap. Those are the four areas that every school is focusing on in various degrees with the overall goal of improving student achievement, student engagement, and decreasing discipline referrals. So what you heard tonight from Josh Eaton is what is happening in every single school in the district. It's going to look a little bit differently depending on the data that they're analyzing and where their gaps are.
Thank you.
I have a question. I do, first of all, an apology. I'm sorry I stepped out. I can feel my cough medicine wearing off. We're after 9 o'clock, so I do apologize. And I particularly apologize if, while I was out of the room, you covered this. But my question is, were you surprised at the results at Eaton this year? Was this what you were prepared for? Did you have a sense that this was going to be a multi-year process? Or did you, and the reason I ask it is I was surprised. I was hoping for better. So what do you attribute it to?
I think the short answer to the question is anytime you start with a certain level, which is where Joshua Eaton is at sort of the level three area, it takes a while for change and for continuous improvement to happen. And so when, going back certainly to look at this slide, the challenge, for me is this slide is sort of attributes a lot of different areas a focus, and I think what I have found, it's some of all of these have had an impact on the scores. And so you, to tackle the improvement process, you have to really uncover a lot of information in each of these areas. So, and some of these are pretty straightforward, you know, just looking at attendance, it's a data number, you can just pull out the data and you can say, look, yep, we have to improve our attendance rate. When you look at K to five instruction, that's a pretty wide topic and a pretty wide conversation. And so my job as the instructional leader is to go into the classrooms and really start to uncover where are the areas for improvement in regards to just our overall instruction. Are we following our pacing guides? Are we holding students to high standards? Are our interventions yielding the results that we want to? So those are some pretty big conversations. So I'm not entirely surprised. Certainly I feel the way you did. I wanted better results, but I also know that change and evolution certainly takes time, and the important thing is that you have to have an urgency and a plan to get there, and that's what I'm committed to, and that's what I hope will continue to happen. And
particularly the urgency. I'm glad that you used that word.
Great. How long did it take for you to uncover the data that you've looked at and those areas that need to be worked on? I mean, that didn't happen overnight, right?
No, it certainly doesn't. I think we've been fortunate that some of the data that's come in is the park data, but I think when you look at the attendance data, I mean, we're fortunate to have the data coach that's helped given me some correlation in regards to what you're talking about regarding reading scores. So I had a chance to go back and look at reading scores starting in kindergarten through third grade and look at the correlation between the reading scores and the park data, as well as, you know, what were the interventions that we put into place for those students, how much regression happens over the summer for those students, and are we putting in specific supports for those students as well? So some of the data is readily certainly at my fingertips. Using the data coach has certainly been a big help. But I think I think the other part that's really been helpful and I'm still uncovering is what do other schools and school systems that are level three to get to level one, what are the things that they've put into place? So I've been fortunate enough to talk to a principal that's been in Winchester, and I certainly had some conversations with the principal in Melrose about what are the specific areas that they had to go through in order to continue to make improvements. So my learning is continuing to evolve.
Was there a change in leadership in the Melrose school, or was it the...
No.
So that's a consideration, too, that if you're there, it's an advantage to right. be able to start sooner than you were.
Right.
But I look at all the everything that's up there in terms of impacting student achievement scores. I'd say 90% of that is not easy to uncover.
Right.
But that applies to all eight elementary schools. I mean, that should be the primer for everybody for student achievement.
And that's why I was prefacing that, you know, Eric is focusing on certain areas. Other schools are looking at some of the similar data, but they may not have to focus on other areas.
Right.
They may not have to focus on student attendance as much.
But when you're doing self-evaluation, that looks like a good list to,
yes.
to work from.
Yes, excellent point.
Yeah, Dr. Doxer.
Thank you. I'm hearing a couple of things. First of all, kudos for coming in control of this whole process. It's all so complicated and not linear. One of the things that I'm hearing really loudly and strongly is the value of this data coach, not just in figuring out the data, but in figuring out the questions and the tools that we need to unpackage the data that will be helpful as tools mm-hmm. going forward. Mm-hmm. And so as someone who wasn't quite sure what a data coach would do, what Courtney would be involved doing, this is really helpful for me to hear. And then the other thing that keeps ringing in my brain is our principals have so many people to evaluate. And when I say evaluate, I mean a multi-step process of figuring out what goals are, what improvement needs to happen, making it collaborative. So that's an interchange, not a gotcha, mm-hmm. and trying to learn from that. And I'm seeing this and thinking, all those things must be on the teacher's purview too, like what's happening in my classroom, how can I figure out what the correlation is between the scores and this, as well as the academic curriculum. And I'm wondering if this is also where the PLCs are coming in handy as part of the process, where the teachers together, both within the schools and across the schools, is that turning out to be a really helpful venue for teachers to unpackage it? And I went to a workshop on the PLCs, and I was very impressed with what was discussed and what the topics are that they're unpackaging and how they work together, and the teacher leaders rise to the top and how they work together. But I just can't conceive of how the principals can do all this. So I'm wondering how that collaboration happens with the PLCs and the teachers.
Yeah, I think the PLCs have had a huge impact just in terms of the types of conversations that are trying to create this level of consistency across the district. And it's been a focus, and it will continue to be a focus, I think, not just with common measures, but what instructional practices lead to the positive results with common measures. And those are things that have to continue to happen. And certainly it helps, you know, from a principal's perspective, to have those professional learning community conversations that happen. I will never argue with you that a principal's job is a lot to take on, and there's a lot to do. And certainly within our jobs, it's a busy time. So that's what I have to do, is prioritize my work and let these types of things be certainly a priority for myself, and also recognize that we want the school environment to be a positive and successful place for everybody that comes in there. So it's striking a balance of all the things that have to happen.
Yep. I just want to say how much the other thing running through my brain is how much I appreciate the work that has gone into this process by the principals, by Craig, Mr. Martin, excuse me, in figuring this out and working towards our school improvement plans and working for the students. I mean, this is huge.
Thank you.
I just want to add about talking about PLCs or data. I've kind of learned myself through this process that a very frustrating but probably necessary step is identifying collectively what is not consistent or what's not working. I've kidded Courtney, for instance, in the data I want her to give a presentation sometime, and I want the title of it to be, well, that's data too. Because, you know, she has said, we'll collect data and you can look at it and just say, this doesn't make sense. It just can't be valid. Or it's not being done the same. It's clear it's not being done the same way. It's not being, you know, and her line to me would be, that's data too. That's sometimes the first important, same with the PLCs, you know, the first year, so much of it was identifying inconsistencies, subtle and not so subtle, in terms of how is it doing, how are things being communicated, sometimes even about us as administrators, how we, you know, staff identifying for us, so that's, you know, it's frustrating in some ways, but I've learned that's also sort of part of the process, is getting it out there on the table. And then I wanted to sort of, you know, give kudos as well to Mr. Sprung here, because I think even the presentation, I mean, yes, the sense of urgency absolutely needs to be there, and it needs to happen as quickly as possible, but I do sense a very different tone, even in the presentation the other night, you know, and parents even commented on it, just the fact that they were parents presenting with Mr. Sprung, you know, that wanted to comment, teachers were there that night, and, you know, I mean, it's hard to measure that, but it's very difficult to take really hard looks at things and make changes when fingers are pointing in all directions, and when people in the community feel like, you know, no, we're in this together, and absolutely, this has to happen, but, you know, for a community to be saying, okay, what can we do to help, and teachers feeling safe to have those conversations at the same time, to raise expectations, knowing that, okay, some kids may not always be making the expectations, but, you know, it's not about the report card or the grades, but, you know, we need to have this reliable data so we can do what we need to do. That can only happen when you have that kind of culture. So I do think that a lot has been done with that. So I commend you for that.
Just one quick comment on data. One thing, having been involved with data-driven decisions and
variety of grants that I've overseen, and also as a curriculum director in Danvers, the one thing that strikes me is the amount of work it takes the teachers. They're really the ones that are collecting the data, looking at it. You know, the data coach obviously is looking at the data that's been collected and making decisions, but it's different than as it was in the past. I mean, there's a lot more emphasis on it. So I think, you know, anything we can do to alleviate that, I don't know if there's anything we can do, particularly under the circumstances, but I think we have to keep that in mind in terms of the expectations we have on teachers.
Absolutely. And at the very least, if it's taking teacher effort, time, instructional time, it better be really meaningful and used in a very productive way. Otherwise, what's the point? And so I think we're taking that point of view. I agree.
There's a very quick question. So, Eric, you spoke about basically benchmarking with Melrose and Winchester and some of your peers about what does it take to get from a level 3 to a level 1, which I think is outstanding. We have other elementary schools that are at level 2 that need to get to level 1. So I'm also hoping that some of that is, you know, shared in your administrative teams about, and maybe some of that also influences sort of what the other elementary schools end up focusing on in terms of goals. I would assume there's some, you know, some leverage or synergy with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think we all need to spend as much time as we can learning from each other. Mm-hmm. I think that has a positive impact that can ultimately will only benefit kids.
That's a good point. Anything?
Thank you for staying out so late and for the presentation and for all you're doing.
Thank you.
Ms. Dowd.
Yes.
So we have scheduled this evening the second reading of the updated student activity account policy JJF that we discussed at last week's meeting as well. So there have been no changes from what was distributed and discussed at last Monday's meeting.
Yes.
Move to accept and approve the second reading of revised policy JJF - student activity accounts.
Second.
Thank you.
And I think we've decided we don't have to start reading it. We can just dispense with the reading, right?
Right. Motion to dispense with the reading.
Second.
All those in favor of dispensing with the reading? 6-0. Wonderful. Any discussion? We had a pretty good discussion last time on this.
I asked all my questions.
Yeah, I started it too. Any discussion or questions on this? Are we ready for a vote?
Yeah.
All those in favor? 6-0. That is great. Thank you, Ms. Dowd. So before we adjourn this evening, there's one final item on the agenda, and it's a continued discussion of the FY18 budget. This has been on our agenda easily every meeting for 6 months, maybe longer. So I know that I'm not the only person in the room who's disappointed at the outcome of the override vote. Beyond that, obviously this is going to impact FY18 in a very significant and serious way. At this point, I think that as a committee, our job is to listen to what the voters said and move forward. I think we need to put kids first. I think we need to really accept that this is going to be a challenging 6 months. It's going to be a very, very challenging 6 months. And from my perspective, this would be a good time for us to come together and get ready to have some robust discussions and some challenging discussions, but really help the community come together and move forward. In that vein, I'd like you to think about before our next meeting. So the next step in the budget process is Dr. Doherty is going to start meeting with building principals in the next few weeks, right, Dr. Doherty, with Ms. Dowd?
Yep.
And that's standard procedure. That's how the budget process always goes. It'll be no different this year, but they're going to be challenging conversations given the $2 million projected budget gap that we're looking at. So what I'd like the committee to be thinking about before our next meeting and come ready to discuss with, are there any, and I'm calling them guiding principles. It's a discussion. We're not going to make a list. We're not going to publish a document, but it's a discussion that we can have about how we would want Dr. Doherty to begin to approach this with administrative staff over the next several months. So not specific
protect this, you know, not specific things, but really broad strokes. What are the things, as he engages in these conversations, you want him to have in his mind as being priorities or principles as we move forward? So, yeah, Mrs. Swift.
So, I guess, can you put the goals slide up for a second? Do you guys have the clicker? I was on the committee from 2003 to 2010 and now again since 2014, and it's going to be very difficult. I'm not quite clear how yet we're going to be able to pull really ourselves and the community together. But I know that as I listened to Mr. Sprung and Dr. Daugherty reference this slide, my stomach's really sort of turning as I look at this. And I know from my past experience during budget cuts like that were not like this. They were not to this magnitude. You know, you said putting kids first. And the thing is, each one of us on this committee and the staff will find different pieces of, you know, what we think is important to putting students first or kids first. And the parents, each parent will have, you know, what they think is important. And, you know, the hardest thing is going to be trying to figure out, you know, where we're going to be able to focus those limited resources. And it's no matter what, it's going to be hard on people. And I know, Dr. Daugherty, the memo that you put out in terms of moving forward was excellent. And, you know, it's hard, difficult to remember, you know, where we have our funding for this budget year. What we're working on is the next budget year. And so as we're talking about the things that we're going to do this year, it's exciting, but at the same time, there's like, it's like in the pit of your stomach. And I am just, you know, I think about all the new teachers. I think about what we're asking of teachers. And I was asking crazy ideas earlier in the week about what we could do. You know, you can't privately fund public education. I don't have enough $1,000 to hand around. But you wish you could, because we're not gonna, because it's going to be really difficult. So I'm really anxious you know, as we get in the process to hear from FinCom and, you know, hear from the town manager, and, you know, I think the step that he took to push off that capital project is, that's $350,000. So we gotta start trying to add up every.
And the lights that was pushed off
earlier,
several months ago.
Yeah, but
right.
That
but to
was
clarify,
well before this
and,
process.
And those are capital expenses.
Yeah,
unfortunately, they're not
going to
help with the operating. I wouldn't want anyone hearing that to think that we're finding huge chunks of money, because those are capital expenses which are completely separate from the operating budget.
I think it's all sort of smart things to do, but that relates to other issues. The capital relates to other issues. So I think that's right. It doesn't relate to our operating budget. So I appreciate that you've asked us to come up with guiding principles, and I've really been thinking a lot about that, and thinking a lot about that with respect to what I've experienced over past years, and trying to think about what I am going to ask, and have that dialogue. And so I appreciate that. I'm just I'm having trouble being as excited about what I heard tonight, which is all awesome and great, but I'm just having, you know, a little.
And I think to your point about crazy ideas, yeah, everything's on the table now.
Yeah.
I think every crazy idea needs to be explored.
Crazy now.
Yep. Thank you, Mrs. Swin.
No, I'd just like to say, you know, I agree with Elaine, but I think, as you said, the famous football coach says, it is what it is, and we really just have to move forward, and that's what the community had, you know, voted, and we just have to adhere to that.
Yeah. And I'd like to think that we maybe can be part of working to shore up staff morale. I think how we move forward and how we work with FinCom and the Board of Selectmen can have an impact, hopefully, on the staff, because I know this is a hard time for them as well. So we'll have a discussion when you see FY18 budget on your agenda for next week, or next, I'm sorry, I keep saying next week, next meeting, November 7th. Be thinking of just a very high level, not specific, high level discussion about how do we approach making service level cuts of this scope.
We'll also have for you that night the budget calendar.
Wonderful.
So that you'll see what it's going to look like between now and town meeting.
And as far as we know, we still do have financial forum on next week.
Next Wednesday.
Can I just make a comment?
I'm sorry, I'm coughing.
So I think our collaboration with FinCom and Selectmen should be about resources, not about value judgments about mm-hmm. what is mm-hmm. right.
Yes.
Yep. Oh, absolutely.
I just was a little uncertain that we really have a lot of information about resources as early as next week.
Well, the reason why, because usually this is in October.
Yeah.
The financial forum, it was pushed to next week because we needed to plan based on the impact of the override, either way.
So this is really late, not early.
This is late, yeah.
Yeah, they have the information.
Yeah, they'll have information.
I don't think FinCom's met. Anyway.
Well, it's their
we'll
meeting.
We'll see
it's
when
their
we
meeting.
Get there.
Dr. Doxer?
I have my tail between my legs a little bit because I'm feeling apologetic about my comment before about us getting a good night's sleep before. You had made a very good point about these are very long meetings and challenging, and the staff and the teachers give 1,000% to be here, 100% when they start at 6 in the morning or before. So I apologize for that before.
You need to apologize.
But on that note, and I just heard Dr. Daugherty say how we're actually starting this process late in terms of, if I interpreted that right, in terms of the guiding principles.
No, we haven't started late internally.
FinCom.
Okay.
FinCom's meeting is a little bit later because we're waiting for the results of the override.
Okay, so then my question was in respect of people's time and energy, I'm wondering if this, the guiding principles, could that be pushed, because we have such important, we have the literacy and we have the superintendent's goals and we have the question too. I'm wondering if that discussion, which will also be a substantive one, whether that might be something we could push to the next meeting. It's just a question. I don't know. I'm just
the next
taking
meeting.
Seriously your feedback.
The next meeting is November 22nd, and I'm guessing you will have already started. I mean, the whole point is to give him some guidance before meeting with principals.
We will have already met with principals by then.
Sorry.
Anything else for this evening? Oh, Mrs. Choice.
I actually have one public announcement I'd like to make. Effective October 31st, I'm resigning from my position from the school committee. I am known for a couple of weeks, and I wanted to wait until the override election, because I didn't want to affect the outcome of that vote in any way, shape, or form. This is strictly a personal decision, and I'm very disheartened that I have to make this announcement, but I've changed my career, and I'm starting a full-time job next Monday, and I can't possibly work full-time, take care of two wonderful, very busy children, and be a valuable member of the school committee. So I appreciate the time that I've spent with everybody. I'm grateful for the people that elected me to this position. And it's really been an honor to serve. I've learned so much, and I don't want anyone to think that I've made this decision because I'm not ready for the hard work that you all have in front of you. I wish I could join you. But unfortunately, I just have to make this decision. I've made this decision that's based best for my family. So, thank you.
You're going to be greatly missed.
Yes.
And I think you would have been a very valuable voice during the very challenging mm-hmm. conversations we have coming up. So you're going to be missed. But I think we can all understand that we all have to make priorities and family first.
Feel free to call us at your time of leisure.
Don't worry.
Stepping down from the committee does not mean you no longer have a voice. You have our phone numbers.
Exactly.
Right. I just want to. Julie was
One more superintendent's evaluation was just going to be too much.
I think that would have pushed me over the edge, absolutely, yeah.
Well, we will miss you. Thank you very much for your service.
Thank you. Thank you for your service. It's quite a thing to run for office and to serve in this position, so thank you for that. All right, anything else for this evening?
Motion to adjourn.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
Oh, great. Second, can I, for my last second?
Your last one, all those in favor.
Thank you, Julie. Looking for a round of applause.